say, I don't own the rights to any music that you hear on the station right now. Gotta say it early. I think they tried to block one of my videos one time before, so I'm gonna just say it early just in case they miss it. So, don't own the rights to any music that you hear on the radio. Welcome to Steel Radio. Thank you for joining me on another cold, cold winter night. We're going to sit here and chill out and listen to this intro for a minute, waiting for my co-host to join us. Hope you guys had a good Sunday. Hope you stayed warm. Hope you're staying warm. But more importantly, hope you guys are staying safe. Once again, this is Steel Radio, baby. We're about to get into it. You know how we do. How's the weather out there, Mama Bean? Is it raining? Is it snowing? Snowing over here, right? Is that Tanya Pooh? I think that's what it says. Welcome, welcome. It's a new face. Welcome. Whoa, it was snowing there yesterday? Craziness. Well, it's definitely snowing down here right now. It's like snowing too. Like, it's crazy. I think right now it's just like turning into icy rain right now. So, I think it's gonna freeze. Or whatever. Tonight. That's what they're saying, so I don't know. We'll just see. Still waiting for my co-host to join in, and get tuned in, get plugged in. So, yeah. I hope everybody's doing okay. But anyway, for all those who are tuning in, I want to say thank you guys for tuning in to Steel Radio. Again, we don't own the rights to any music that we play on the station. So Sometimes we just like to play stuff just to, you know, chill out, get us in the mood. This just happens to be my Smooth Intro song that I like to play. It keeps me mellow, very mellow. So, what's up, yo? How you feel?
I'm okay. I have a sick daughter, so I was trying to get her squared away.
I can dig it. I totally understand that.
Before I came on. And guess what? I'm very excited about.
What?
Today, I think I'm going to be able to have wine for the first time since last Sunday.
Oh, okay.
Because remember, I was sick on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Yesterday, I felt like, hey, I'm about 85%. And so today, I feel like I'm ready to try wine.
Okay. I mean, well, listen. No one's going to stop you from getting your wine on. Go ahead and get your
wine on. You know I need libations for the show, so.
Okay. I mean, get your libations on. So.
Hello, everyone who's watching.
Before we get kicked off this thing, I just want to say thank everyone for tuning in to Steel Radio. I'm your man, Steel. That is my lovely co-host, Ebony, a.k.a. Miss Hot Topic, who always brings the dirt.
She's a little bit better. I don't bring any dirt, though.
I mean, you do. Okay, and you're about to have your what's it called? Libations or vibations?
It's called libations.
I'm gonna let you handle that word.
Okay, first of all, you should note that word. It's used in African culture, and they will pour libations out for their ancestors. Libation.
I'm not African, so I don't know that.
So you didn't learn anything about Kwanzaa or during Kwanzaa at all. You ain't never been nowhere where they said we're gonna pour libations.
I mean, I know what Kwanzaa is. It's supposed to be like the Negro, is it Negro? Holiday or something like that? I don't know. Something like that. But I never celebrated Kwanzaa.
You need to know what you need.
I mean, I know you say Happy Kwanzaa or Merry Christmas, right? Or that for, right?
Nobody says Merry Christmas. What are you talking about?
I said Merry Christmas, right?
I thought you said Christmas, like Kwanzaa for Christmas.
No, I said Merry Christmas, and people say Happy Kwanzaa.
Yes. Okay.
Right?
Some people say Happy Kwanzaa.
So I don't even know who's watching.
Who's watching? I know that First Class Boxer is here. Sneezy is here. Mama B is here. Those are the names that I see in front of me right this minute.
Oh, okay. So where's the green eyed genie? Where's he at?
Sun Kissing is here, and Tonapu is here. Hello, welcome all of those people who are here. He is at work. He was supposed to be off earlier, but, you know, he's a manager, so when his employees don't show up, he has to do it.
Okay. I get that. Okay, I just like to just check.
How was y'all's weekend? How was your weekend? It's Sunday. How was your weekend?
My weekend has been pretty cool. I haven't really done too much other than just, I worked basically. That's about it. And then I was just standing stuff
today, so. All work and no play.
Mm. I mean, you know, same old for me. You know, gotta work. You know, the cold can't stop this. You know, doesn't stop bills. So you gotta get out here and get in the cold.
Oh, I don't know not about that. It was a sunny 50-some degrees here today.
Good luck to you. Well, it's a cool 17 degrees over here right now. It's cold. It's snowing. It's icy. It's horrible outside right now. So you got your, what is it, Vibrations.
Libations.
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 Okay. Okay. Well, I'm getting my libations on too right now with this deliciousness that I'm eating right now. And it's tasty. Don't you know that? Hello, everyone who's joining. What's that? Eva. I can't pronounce you guys' Instagram names. I'm going to need people to have like normal names that I can understand. So,
envy is a word. It's in.
That's better. You're having technical difficulties over there. Hold on, let me get you back. Total technical difficulties over there. Okay, we're having little technical difficulties. We will get Ebony back into the feed in just a moment. While we're doing that, I just want to say hello to everybody who's joining. I'm seeing some new faces of people that I've never seen before. So thank you for tuning in. Glad you're here. Please forgive us right now. Again, we are having some slight technical difficulties. It could be due to the weather, but she said it's sunny in Oklahoma, so don't quite know what's going on. So just give us a few minutes and we will get the show going in a moment. So let's see.
I don't know what happened. I wasn't even touching the phone when it happened.
You was doing something you had no business doing.
I was fussing at you about not being able to read that word envy. And then I just heard music on my phone and it was like, thanks for joining. It logged me off. So I don't know.
That's your little, you probably was watching. You was probably watching something you had no business watching.
I prefer making it, not watching it, sir.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, shit. I get it. I hear that. Okay.
But I welcome. That is a new name, Miss New Vintage Curvy Life, and it's Envy Inspired Life was the name you were trying to say.
Yeah, I can't say all them names.
I usually just say like the first part of it, so I'll be like Envy said, "Hey, Jai, right. Thanks for joining us." So are we ready to get into it or what are we doing?
I mean, I'm ready. I'm ready to get into it. You want to get into it? Let's get into it.
Okay.
I'm down.
So tonight we're talking about relationship deal breakers.
Relationship deal breakers.
Like, yeah, if you were in a relationship or even like getting to the place where you're considering whether to be in relationship with a person, what are your deal breakers?
What are my deal breakers? Deal breakers. I think, you know, I guess just like anything else, I guess for everybody, it's probably a little different because, I mean, you know, we've talked about a few things before. Like one thing, if we're about to date or currently dating or something like that, you already know, like, I'm not good with the pop-up. That's a deal breaker for me. Pop-up is a problem.
Wait. So if you were let's say you're already in a relationship with a person and they popped up, that's a deal breaker? Like, deal breakers are like, I can no longer be in this relationship with you. It's a deal breaker. That's what you're saying?
Like, at all? Like, I mean, is like there's any like a little small room for negotiation or though?
No, because then it's not a deal breaker, right? Deal breakers means the deal is off. I've got to break this deal. The deal is off. This is something that I'm saying I can't live with and I can't do. It's a deal breaker for me.
Like, you absolutely just is like completely over. Yeah. No negotiables. Like, nothing negotiable. Like,
once a person crosses this line, we can't go back for you.
We can never go back. Okay.
Audience, I want you guys to tell us what your deal breakers are. You know, one of my deal breakers is definitely your hygiene. Hygiene, right? If you don't have, if you have poor hygiene, it's a no for me.
Well, here's the thing about the hygiene thing. Like, would that even be considered a deal breaker?
Yeah, because to me, I consider, like, of course, everyone knows showering, brushing your teeth, stuff like that. But I consider if you won't maintain a haircut, listen, me and Brian, he's going through this phase and he doesn't want to shave. Me and Brian have had some come to Jesus talk because, like, this is becoming a deal breaker for me. Like, you can't walk around looking like a caveman. I don't like it, and I can't deal with it. And like I told him, I can't walk around. Well, I could. It maybe wouldn't bother him. You know, he's so nonchalant. But I don't walk around my hair all over my head. I try to look presentable for you. So I don't want, you can't do that. It's a deal breaker.
But that's really a deal breaker, though. Like, so if Brian decided, look, check it out. Look, I'm going through some man shit right now. I just don't want to cut my hair.
And for how damn it, long? But for how long?
Hold on. And damn it, I just don't want to shave. You mean to tell me your whole marriage and everything that you worked so hard for is about to be over because of uncut hair and an uncut shaved face?
Well, so really, to me, it depends on how long, right? How long has this been going on? Like you said, everybody gets a period. You know what I mean? If you need a month, two, maybe even 3 months, but that's really pushing it. Like I'm because I don't, because here's what happens. What happens is now I'm no longer attracted to you, right? Why do I want to be in a relationship with someone that I'm no longer attracted to? Now I turn and look at you and be like, ugh, I don't want that for the person that I'm in a relationship with.
But listen, so, okay, so I'm just saying, I mean, I get it, but I don't think that, or I'm going to assume, because you know I like to assume shit, right? So I'm not going to assume that your whole relationship is and marriage is based off of a haircut and a beard. I'm sure
it's
that
not. It's not. Of course my whole relationship is not based off of that. However, you're not alone, right? Just like I'm not alone. The same, like a man or woman might sit around farting and scratching all day by themselves. But you don't necessarily do that when you're not alone. So for me, it's like, I want to be attracted to you when I look over at you. And at a certain point, it just becomes unattractive to me.
Right. But I'm saying, does love and does like love of the heart, does that not supersede?
Well, here's the thing. It might be when you're married, of course. Of course, I would never be getting a divorce because my husband won't shave or get a haircut. Of course, I wouldn't be getting a divorce. However, I feel like it would put some strain on the marriage eventually because now I'm no longer attracted to you. For us, it's a little different because, you know, we're poly. So, like, I could probably get some of those needs met with somebody else. But I married you, so I want those needs met with you as well. So I just feel like eventually, Mama B says it's vain. It can be vain, but I don't have a problem telling my truth. And that's my truth, is that I just, Toma said, Tona, I'm sorry. Tona says, for me, it would be multiple cheating. Multiple cheating is a deal breaker.
Deal breaker. That's it. I mean,
I agree. Like, I can forgive you once, maybe even twice, depending upon the circumstances and that kind of thing. But we're not going to keep doing this. Like, after a while, it's like, no, you're just doing your thing right now.
Right, so I think that would definitely be a deal breaker, you know? Like, if it's going to continue to happen, unless it was a situation where, you know, both parties sat down and had, like, a coming to Jesus moment to say, look, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, just like, you know, you have car insurance and your car insurance is due, or you know what I'm saying? Your car insurance always update. Well, maybe, you know, in the relationship, you know, we might have to update this relationship, meaning like we might need to bring about some new rules if you feel like, you know, this is something that you want to do. So if you're going to continue to do it, but there's still some kind of love or feelings there, then, you know, maybe we need to evaluate and say, maybe we might move into an open relationship, or maybe, hey, maybe you could do the the Ebony and Brian street dance, probably, who knows? You never know. But I think at
Wait,
some point
so,
in time you
so for to, you for so for you cheating is not at all, it's not a deal breaker.
I mean,
not a lot of men, women I have noticed are way more forgiving of that. But a lot of men, in fact, most men that I've come across, once the woman cheats, it's like over for them. So are you saying that's not necessarily the case for you?
No, what I'm saying is I've been in relationships where I have been cheated on. And the first time the woman, you know, well, I might have found out that the woman's cheated on me, I didn't necessarily be like, okay, I'm out the door after the first one. Because then sometimes I'll be like, okay, well, I'll listen to your story. I'll find out, okay, did I have anything to do to contribute to maybe how you were feeling? You know, it could have been me. I could have done something and you felt a certain
or
kind
not
of way.
Done something.
Huh?
Or not done something.
Yeah, I mean, so I mean, I'll find out what it is and find out the real story, you know what I'm saying, behind what it is and why you did it. And then, so like the first time I'm probably, I'll be mad-ish. It depends, you know what I'm saying? It depends on where we are in our relationship. So I might be mad about it, but, you know, I might still stay the first time. But if it becomes like, if it becomes like a serial thing, like you keep on doing it, or you tell me that you're not going to do it again, and then I catch you, then yeah, I'm going to have to go ahead and raise up out of that. So, you know. Your peace be unto you.
Devious Tattoo says, don't break my trust. That's a deal breaker for him. Tona says, when you do it continuously, it's not acceptable. I have been cheated on multiple times, and I got fed up and ended things over the course of a few years.
Yeah. So I just think.
Well, do you think, because this is veering off a little bit, but do you think that, because I know some people, first of all, I hate when people use the phrase like once a cheater, always a cheater, once a liar. I feel like, you know what I mean? Everybody can change, you know. But Tanya, okay. Do you feel that if you forgive someone and stay with someone who's cheated on you, that you kind of sending them the message that it's okay?
If you forgive them?
Yeah, like do you think that forgiving a person and saying, I'm going to look past the fact that you cheated, does that give them the message that it's okay if they cheat again?
No, I don't think it's giving them like free rein to do it again. I mean, I think that you have to have a serious conversation if you yourself decide that you even want to stay in it to begin with, you know what I'm saying? Because you can't say you forgive them and then keep bringing it up all the time, because then that's just like, what's the point? You might as well just go ahead and just get rid of the person altogether. So I don't think it's necessarily saying, you know.
No, I don't know. I don't mean that. I don't mean that. That's what you're saying. I mean, do you think that they get the feeling that like, oh well, they forgave me this time, they'll do it again?
I guess it really just all depends on the individual. You know what I'm saying? And how they look at it. I mean, if they're truly sorry and truly remorseful and truly want to work things out with you, then they probably won't feel that way. But if they really don't give a fuck, then they like, shit, you know what I mean? Then they might go out there and do it again. Who knows?
Well, Tanya says yes. And Mama B says, not the first time, but once they keep doing it, yes. Now, let me ask you another question from a male point of view. Mm-hmm. I've heard males say that, like, they weren't cheating. They weren't doing anything they were supposed to do. But because she kept accusing them of doing it, they decided, I might as well just go ahead and do it. Is that a real thing? Is that y'all's thought process?
How do I put this delicately? Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Really?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Why?
It's like, I don't know how old everybody is, but if you're old enough, you might have heard this saying before. You ever heard somebody say, oh, I'm going to give you something to cry about?
Yes.
You ever heard that saying before? Well, yeah. So it's like, sometimes like what I'm saying is, if you are being a man and you're not doing anything wrong, you think that you are doing what you're supposed to do in your relationship, But if every time you turn around, you know, you're being accused of things that you aren't doing, or being places that you aren't, that you haven't been, or just whatever, or like every time, you know, let's say for instance, somebody leaves a, I don't know, says happy birthday on your birthday on your Facebook page, like everybody else.
But it's the
Oh,
same woman that's always making comments, so we
like
know.
what? You know what I'm saying? Like, who is this bitch? Keep making comments. What? Oh. So not only does this bitch want to say happy birthday, she got the nerve to put a smiley face emoji. Who is this emoji sending bitch? You know, they look like, come on, man, really? It's social media. Calm down. You know what I'm saying? So I mean, if you get, if you, you know what I'm saying? If it gets to the point where you just keep accusing me of the same shit, then, you know, I'm not gonna lie. There have been times in my former life I'm like, well, shit, I'm gonna give you something to cry about. I'm gonna go out here. I'm gonna do what you keep accusing me for. Now you got something to cry about. I mean, I've done it. I'm not saying I do it now, but I've done it. I'm not gonna lie.
So
I've
everybody's
done
agreeing, people are agreeing with you in the comments. So ladies, take notes if you have some insecurity issues, because that's really what that boils down to, right? You have some, or, but what about this? What about this? What about this? Let's say you have cheated on her in the past. She knows that. You discussed it. You've been through it. She said, I'm going to stay with you. Now, most people know that once their infidelity or cheating has come into view, now everything is being scrutinized a lot more closely, right?
Absolutely.
So now, after you, if do you already been caught cheating or whatever, and she's starting, and so that means, like I said, she's watching everything more closely. She may question you way more often. You sure you wasn't doing this? You sure what is, will that push you over, or will you just chalk that up to, I'm just trying to gain her trust back and I'm not going to cheat again?
Oh, see, then now that one, see, you're good. You be asking some real good damn questions, bro. You be asking the real shit. Like, that's a real good question. Like, it's really good. So my answer to that is simply like this. If you get caught cheating, you have to understand that at that point, there's probably going to be little to no trust. And you're definitely going to have to, you're definitely going to have to rebuild that. So you're going to have to walk a little differently. You're going to have to see things. You're going to have to do things a little differently. So you're going to expect some kind of extra checking on her part or whatever. So you can't really get mad for a while. But let's just say, like, but it
But how
can't
do you
be.
determine what the wild is? Like,
No, what I'm saying is, listen, but I'm gonna hold on. What I'm saying, but what it can't be a free for all. You get what I'm saying? That sometimes women, if you got caught cheating, now it becomes a free for all. Like all your personal space is forever violated. And now we're like 6 months down the road and you still bringing up Keisha. Like, I don't even talk. What? You know what I'm saying? Yeah, or like, seriously, like, it's a situation where, perfect example. It was like it, you could be in a situation like this. Let's just say the chick's name was Keisha. Let's just throw that name out there. I'm not saying it is, but like say there was a name, Keisha. 6 months, things are going pretty good. Now you're sitting there and you're watching TV. You're watching, I don't know, Family Feud, and just so happened the chick in the family on Family Feud, Family Feud, he says, "Come on, Keisha, let's come." And now it's like, oh. Does that remind you of somebody? Oh, he's thinking about Keisha now. And then, like, for the next week after this damn show, now, oh, when was the last? Then it turns to, when was the last time you talked to Keisha? You know, I had a dream about this. And then, like, really? Because we watching Family Feud right now? So it has to be at some point in time. It has to be a cutoff. You can't just because you get caught doing something, it doesn't mean I'm still doing it. It doesn't give you a free for all to go on like months and
But
months
how
and
do you
months, like.
determine how long it should be before the cutoff? Like
Well,
6 months may seem long, but it's really not that long.
what I'm saying is, for me, I can't speak about everybody else, right? You have about 6 months with me. I know that sounds harsh, especially if I was the one in the wrong, but you got about 6 months. If I do something wrong and you want to keep bringing this shit up, like beyond the 6 month period, then I'm gonna go. I'm gonna just go ahead and go. Not because I'm not going to want to stay in that where like every day or you just feel like this, you're just gonna drag this shit out for months and months and months at a time. Like I'm not gonna do it. Like what's the point? Like there's not gonna be any peace because any peace that we try to have is gonna always be you keep bringing the shit up. Like so I'm good. Like I mean no hard feelings. I'm sorry. I did wrong. I'll accept my punishment, but I'll fuck that out. And listen, I keep it moving.
So she has to deal with the hurt and pain that you inflicted on her. But when you feel a little uncomfortable past the time you want to be uncomfortable, then it's just
Yeah.
over.
I'm good. I'll give you 6 months. 6 months of pain. I get it. I'll kiss your ass. I'll, and do some shit that you asked me to do. I'll be it. Should I come in before the street lights? So you want me in the street before the street lights? Okay, I'll come in before the street lights. Whatever. You know what I'm saying? Like I'll give you leeway to ask me your demands, what you want. I don't know if it's, I don't know, check my phone when I come in, his phone. I don't, you want to go through it. Okay, hear it. I mean, whatever stipulations we say, but then after that, like, what the fuck? We can't continue and forever to live in the space of what I've done because then we're never going to get past it because we're always going to be reminded of it. So then, what's the point? So where's the happiness at that point? You know what I mean?
I agree. Let's read some comments. Tanya says, I didn't accuse at first. Then I accused, and we had a conversation. And he said, if you accuse me, then I should go do it. But then there was times my women's intuition kicked in, and I was right. Miss New Vintage says, I'm guilty of doing that. Doing the whole thing where you're talking about the whole family feud thing.
Well, it's
Demon's
happened.
Tattoo says, if you forgive me, then don't keep bringing it up. If you expect it to go any further in the relationship, then Tanya says, how can you put a time on a woman's pain?
No, I mean, what I'm saying is, you can't necessarily put time on a woman's pain. And I'm not saying that.
He's just putting time on how long he's going to deal with it.
You have all the time you want. You can take a year, you can take 2 years to deal with the pain, and that's cool. I'm not saying you can't take that time. But what I'm saying is, I'm not going to take 2 years with you or anything beyond 6 months to the point where you're going to keep because it's just creating even more pain if you just keep bringing it up, bringing it up, keep bringing it up. So what's the point? Like, there's not going to be no peace there. There's not going to be no happiness there. So rather than do that and continue to just bring about more pain, I would rather just go ahead and like, all right, I'm sorry, I apologize, and it doesn't seem like you really want to get past it, or you still need more time, but I'm not willing to sit there for a year and just get back, bashed and badgered because of a mistake that I made like a year ago. Like I'm not gonna do it. So I'll be out. I'm
I
out of
do
that.
agree that, because you said something important. You said, I'm willing to do whatever it is that she needs me to do to help her feel more comfortable. So if that's look through my phone, if that's be home by a certain time, I do agree if you are willing to do all those things and you're doing all those things for 6 months straight, that there does have to be a time where it's just like, what are we doing?
What are we doing? Yeah. Man, come on now.
And you're right. Tanya said, I agree. It's the same if the shoe was on the other foot.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. You can't just
Okay.
keep bashing somebody about it all the time.
Okay, so multiple cheating is a deal breaker.
Deal breaker.
What else is a deal breaker? We had, on the last show, some people said the deal breaker might be you not having any religious beliefs. Most people said you don't have to have the same exact one that I do, but you have to have some type of spiritual beliefs.
Yeah. Too for me, too much drinking for me, that would be a deal breaker for me. Like that's
And
I
what's too
can't do
much
that.
drinking?
Too much drinking for me. Let's see, how many days a week is it?
Seven.
Okay, so if you're drinking more than 4 or more days a week for me, I'm deal
Like,
breaker.
what do you mean by drinking? Like, if they're just having a glass of wine every day after work?
No, if you go out and drink every day, like if you go out and drink at least 4 days a week, that's a deal breaker. I'm good. I'll be by myself. I'm good with that. You know what I'm saying? Like that's just like come on. Like that's ridiculous. So
Okay.
yeah. Deal breaker.
What else is a deal? You know, it's a deal breaker for me if, honestly, if my kids don't like you.
You know, that was a topic that I kind of like wanted to go into one day. We'll have to do it today, but that could like segue into like later conversation though. Cause, like, what do? If you're dating somebody and your kids just don't like that person, do you just not date the person because your kid don't like them? That's a good question.
Well, for me, it's a, you know, I sit down with my kids and it's about, well, why don't you like them, right? And sometimes it just depends on the reasons why they don't like them. Because sometimes kids can just be kids. And, you know, I remember that my son went through a phase where, like, he just didn't really want anybody else around. As far as he was concerned, he was my man. So that was a different, you know, that was just something different to deal with. It wasn't that he didn't like him as a person. It was just, I don't like any other man around.
Right.
And he was the first person I had ever brought around since their father. So, I mean, but ultimately, part of the reason why that relationship ended is just for that reason. Because the other thing was that, so maybe also a deal breaker for me is too drastic of a difference in how we want to raise the kids.
Right.
Because here he was, he never had any kids. Mm-hmm. You know, he came into my life when my kids were pretty much preteens. And, you know, he was trying to tell me, you're too soft on him. Now, it's not to say that he didn't have some valid points, but at the same time, you don't even have kids. Like, well, when I was younger, I did this. When you were younger, they weren't killing people on the bus. Like, you know what I'm saying? And so for me, it was just a lot of stuff that, like, I don't, and it wasn't anything I was asking him to do. I'm going to go pick my kids up. I'm going to drop them off. And we had a lot of fights about that type of thing. And to me, it just ultimately, I'm going to probably always choose my kids unless my kids are just completely in the wrong.
Right.
And it just, it didn't work for me. Devious Tattoo says, yes, if my kids don't like you, then bye.
Well, see, okay, well, I don't know. It would all depends on why, you know, my children didn't like the person. Because like you said, sometimes kids just don't like people just because,
right,
you know, they don't like them. If they don't really have a valid reason other right. than, what, you know, dad, I just don't like them, like, okay. You might not like what I do. You know what I'm saying? So I'm going to need you to sit down for a little bit and, you know, and then we'll figure it out. You know what I'm saying? Because sometimes a child could say they don't like somebody just because they may not be used to you being with someone.
Right.
They might not be used to someone, you know, being in your personal space like that. Or sometimes a child, I'll speak about my own child, Bree, at one point was just like, no, you can't ever date nobody ever in life, because she just felt like if I started dating somebody that I was going to forget about her and she wasn't going to be my princess anymore. You know what I'm saying? That type of thing.
Yeah, I was going to say that was kind of what my son went through. It was like, now this man is getting some of my attention, right?
Yeah.
And that was difficult for them, right? Because when it was just us, they had all my attention all the time. Now there are times that, you know, I'm going to be spending with him. So it was really that. It wasn't that they didn't necessarily like him as a person. But then at the same time, I don't know, you know, I also felt like, and that's maybe something that, you know, me and Brian don't really have these struggles, but for me, it was like, so this is probably going down a whole nother road. Like, I get that we're supposed to think about them as our kids, 'cause now we're together, but ultimately they my kids. Right. And so like one of his issues with them was that he felt like I spoiled them. And I was like, but so what? Like, they're my kids. And if I want to buy them stuff, I buy them stuff. I didn't ask you to buy it. You know what I mean? I didn't take any of your money to do it. I can afford to do it. So I don't understand why we're having this discussion. I wanted to buy my son a shirt. I bought him a shirt. Now, is that wrong thinking?
No, I wouldn't say it was. I mean, you know, you wouldn't say it's wrong. I mean, that's your perspective. So wrong.
But as a man, I'm asking, like, how do you feel about that?
Can't really feel too much way about it, I guess. You know what I mean? So, like I said, you can kind of feel some way, but at the end of the day, it's that person's child. You know what I'm saying? So you can't feel but some so much about it. You know what I mean? So like Bree, again, Bree didn't like nobody. Like, but she didn't like nobody. Like nobody. You know what I'm saying? She just wasn't having it. But then again, at the end of the day, you have to be happy. You know what I'm saying? Like, I have to be happy too. Like, I can't, I don't want to just be by myself forever. So, you know what I'm saying? So eventually she, you know, she ended up calming her nerves down because, you know, she still realized that whoever I was going to be with, she still was going to be the princess either way. So, you know what I'm saying? She was good.
Yeah.
Long as she didn't feel slighted or like somebody was just, like she was no longer important to me because of this new person. That's
correct. Yeah, I remember I had a situation, and here's the other thing. You know, I used to always explain to him, like, my kids are not young. I think that, like, the way you come into, like, a 5-year-old's life is very different mm-hmm. than the way you come into a 15-year-old's life, right? So, mm-hmm. you know, he's my boyfriend or whatever. He eventually moved in. And he went from being, like, they friend, you know mm-hmm. what I mean, where basically they just laugh and joke and play, so one day he just decided, I'm the dad now. And my kids is kind of looking like, who the hell are you?
Who are you? Like, what?
And so I remember I was at work one day and I got a call from him, the boyfriend at the time. Well, he was my fiance at the time. And he was like, you know, my son had hit him or something like that. So I'm like, wait, what happened? So I come home and apparently my son was on the porch outside with his friends. You know how kids do when they get together. They cussing up a storm outside.
Mm-hmm.
So he decides to go outside and basically embarrass him and bring him in the house. So now my son is upset or whatever because he's embarrassed. But at that point, he still hadn't disrespected him or said anything to him. He stomped down the stairs. And at the time, my older son was maybe like 16.
Mm-hmm.
But it was my middle son who was at the time, he had to be about 13. 12, 13. So he stomps downstairs where my son is, my oldest son, and then the boyfriend followed him downstairs. I guess he didn't like the fact that he stomped downstairs. So he followed him downstairs and he ended up like jerking him up or something like that and pushed him into the wall or something. And so my oldest son hit him.
Hit the dude?
Yeah. And so, you know, my oldest son was like, Ma, you always say nobody should be putting their hands on, you don't even let me hit him. He was like, you always say nobody should be putting their hands on your child. So why does he think he can come down here and do that? So the fiance was ultimately upset because I wasn't really mad at the kids, right? And I told my fiance, I was like, you handled that entire situation wrong. Right. First of all, why would you go outside and embarrass him in front of his friends? It just wasn't necessary, right? It wasn't needed. But for whatever reason, you felt like you had to, you know, exert your I'm the parent here today. And look where all of this went. So he ended up being mad at me because he said I didn't take his side.
Okay, I mean.
Was I wrong? You think I was wrong?
It depends. It depends. Like, I always feel like when dealing with children, like, you don't necessarily, like, if you're going to do it, like, don't do it. With, like, don't take or not take either one side in front of the other person.
Well, you know I didn't saying? Do it in front of anybody. Like, the conversation okay. I had with him was a private Mine. Conversation. And then I had a conversation with, you know, my kids as well. But, no, I never did that in front of anybody.
Okay, well, then that's different. Then. You know what I mean? That's different. As long as you just don't do it in front of them, you know what I'm saying? Then that's a little different. Because then it's like undermining the person. Did you at least get his side of the story as to why he did it? What did you? You know what I'm saying? Did he give you a reason as to why he did it?
He just said that he was outside cussing, and he shouldn't have been outside cussing like that.
Oh.
Lil Buckshot says it's many women who would decide to stop dating someone because their children doesn't like the new person you're dating. And he thinks I was wrong in this situation.
Oh, okay. I'm glad. I'm just glad there's other men in here commenting today, so I don't feel like all left out by myself. I appreciate the fellas. Thank you, fellas, for coming through. You know what I'm saying? Dropping some comments. Appreciate you. You know what I'm saying? I don't know you, but thank you. Yeah.
So, yeah, ultimately, you know, and he would get upset about, like, you know, he didn't understand why the bathroom need to be clean and the kid didn't just clean it. And I was like, listen, again, you don't have kids, but I can tell you that, like, there is no teenager in the world that will walk past the bathroom and be like, this bathroom needs to be clean. I'm going to just clean it without anybody telling him to do it.
Hold on, say that again. I didn't hear you. You said what now?
He would get upset. Like, he would say that, you know, he didn't understand why my kids didn't just clean something because it needed to be cleaned, why they had to be told to clean it. And I was like, there's no teenager that's going to walk past something and say, oh, that needs to be cleaned. Well, there may be a couple. But the average teenager isn't going to walk past the bathroom and say, that bathroom needs to be cleaned, and just clean it without you telling them to do it.
Oh, well, that's true. That's true. But it doesn't mean that it's not something that maybe he might not have experienced in his life or the way he was raised. You know what I mean? Like, for me, growing up, I was raised like, listen, ain't no dishes in no sink. Like, if you use it, you clean it, period. Like, I don't like dishes in the sink. When you finish with it, you clean it, you put it up, and let's keep that thing rocking. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, listen. But here's the other thing. And like I told him, he didn't even speak to his mom. Like, they had no relationship whatsoever. They didn't even speak. And I said, if you feel like you were raised in such a wonderful manner, but now you have no relationship with your mom and you don't speak to her, that's not what I want.
Right.
So you're not going to really be able to use that as the most exemplary way to raise a kid when you don't even speak to your own mother. Right. Buckshot says he knows me personally and he thinks I was wrong. I don't care. I may have been wrong, but guess what? That's ultimately one of the reasons why we didn't work, because I wasn't going to do that the rest of my life. I wasn't going to have my kids be uncomfortable. I just wasn't doing it. Now, Brian, you know, on the other hand, he didn't come in trying to say, hey, I'm the man and I'm dad now. Like, he's built a rapport with them. He's built a relationship with, and that was the only thing I used to always say to him. You have to build a rapport. You have to build a relationship. They're not five. You can't just jump in and be like, hey, I said do it. And they don't even know who you are, really. Like, they know who their father is. It's not like they've been fatherless all their lives. You know what I mean? So it was just a whole different situation. The only thing I kept saying to him was, you have to approach things very differently with older kids than you may have to with younger kids.
Now, okay, do you think, especially with older kids, or just kids, period, do you think there should still be a level of respect that
of children course.
Should, I don't know, and how they should conduct themselves around,
of you course.
Know, with someone that you're dating?
Of course.
Because I know some kids that be on some, like, nigga, you ain't my daddy. Hey, you ain't my daddy, nigga.
No, not at all. Of course. You know what I mean? And what has happened is, because of the way Brian has approached things, my daughter, she calls him dad. Like, when she doesn't usually say it to him. Like, she'll call him Brian when she talks to him. But when she's talking about him, she says, uh-huh. My dad. Right? You know what I mean?
Okay.
Or she'll be like, I'm going to just go ask my father. You know what I mean? But that's the relationship that they ultimately ended up building. And, right. And it's not to say that I'm not encouraging it. So it's been times that, like, I'm at work. My daughter, Brian, is home. My daughter will call me and say, Mom, can I do so-and-so and so-and-so? And I'll be like, isn't Brian home? Well, yeah, ask Brian. He's the adult that's there right now. You know what right. I mean? But so I know that some of it is something that I'm going to have to encourage. But at the same time, I can't force you guys to have a relationship.
Right.
Now, my son is 20. And so I had to have the same conversation with him. So what was happening was, Brian would come tell me what my son did or said that got on his nerves or whatever. Then my son would come and tell me what Brian did, that, you know, and I'm looking at both. I'm not doing this. You know what I mean? And I told them, y'all need to have a conversation with each other. The only way you're going to build a relationship, the only way nobody's going to be uncomfortable or whatever, is if you have a conversation with each other. We have to increase the communication in this house, because I don't want to be the person that's in the middle all the time.
Right.
And so one day we had like a family meeting. It got kind of heated, you know what I mean? My son got kind of heated, got a little disrespectful. Brian got a little heated, you know, and there were times I had to say, wait a minute, that's too far, whatever. But ultimately it led to an understanding that we now all have. They have a better relationship. They have better communication. But I was like, it has to happen because I don't got time.
Like when you said that, like Brian said some things and your son said some things, I instantly start thinking of the scene from Baby Boy. I instantly thought of that when your son was talking shit to Brian, probably talking shit to Brian, and they like, yeah, get your punk ass on. And they laid on the couch and Brian came behind, ugh, hit like that.
You know what I mean? For me, it was like, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to be in between you all the time. Like, you know, I'm not doing that.
Right.
And it would be simple things. You know what I mean? Simple things that I just was like, yeah, I'm not doing this. I'm just not. So we also do a lot of things together as a family. You know, we had game night and stuff like that. Because otherwise, at this age and stage, you're never going to get to know each other if we don't do stuff like that.
Right. This is true.
So we veered off. But back to the deal breakers.
Okay.
Oh. So the only one you said was what?
I mean, multiple cheating. Yeah, I'm still not a fan of popping up. Like, I don't really do the pop-up shit. Like, it's a deal. Okay, the first time you do it, I might be like, listen, we already had this talk. Second time you do it, listen, I'm telling you, we didn't already had this talk. If you haven't got it by the third time, like, I'm good. Like, I can't keep telling you, like, don't do that. Like, you need to call me and say, hey, well, don't just do that. You know what I mean? Don't do that. That's not cool.
Okay. So, multiple cheating. Pop-ups. That's all your deal breakers?
Okay. Oh, I told you, like, too much drinking. Like, I'm not doing it.
Oh, yeah,
too much drinking.
I can't do that. That's a deal breaker. I'm not gonna do two rides. You know, so let me ask this. Let's assume that while you're dating. Are your dating deal breakers different than when you're in a relationship?
No.
No? Because I feel like when you're dating, you don't know them as well. You haven't built, you know what I mean? Y'all not in a relationship yet. So it could be a lot easier for you to be like, yeah, I don't want to do that no more. Because like for me, when I'm dating or someone's trying to date me, I always say like my cutoff game is so strong. Like immediately when I see some stuff I don't want to be bothered with, I'll be like, yeah, no. I'm done deal.
Well, I mean, I think it's still the same for me because if you, like, say you're trying to get to know somebody and they're already, you know, messing with your, you know, your deal breakers, then you already know that if you were to get into a relationship, it would be the same thing. So why even get there, if that makes any sense? You know what I'm saying?
Well, see, so for me, when I say like my cutoff game, it doesn't even necessarily have to be a deal breaker, right? Like if I just don't like something that he said or did, if we got in a relationship or whatever and we just trying to figure it out, it's easy for me to be like, yeah, I don't want to do that.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's a strong possibility too. Like I don't like to do a deal breaker for me sometimes. And then sometimes, you know, depending upon who it is, you might cut them a little slack sometimes. Like, I don't like the back and forth shit. Like, I don't. That's exhausting. That shit gets exhausting.
What's the back and forth shit, though?
Like, oh, my God. I don't know. Like, say you're like, I don't have a good example. It might not be a good example. But, like, say you're. If you keep going back and forth about the same situation, about the same, and you keep coming back to the same street, it's like you're in a turnabout, you just keep coming back to the same street. Like, I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that shit. I don't want to do it. Like, I'm not going to do it. Like, we're not going to keep going back and forth about the same
Mama
shit.
Mama B says, how you act during the dating phase, you will act in the relationship.
Yeah, this is true. I hate to bring it up.
Usually the dating phase, you still try to, bring your representative. So even your representative get on your nerves, you might as well just cut it.
You already know. If you send in your representative, and your representative, who's your best spokesman, is getting on my nerves. Nigga, when you get into office, you know you're not going to be in office long at all. You're not going to be even be in office long. You know what I'm saying? Shit, I be out of there.
Nitra says, if I'm in the early dating phase, a huge deal breaker for me is a person who don't keep their word. I don't do well. Oh, Nitra, she says, I don't do well with inconsistent people. Listen, you just said a word right there. My biggest deal breaker, my two biggest deal breakers are lying to me and being inconsistent. I have three rules in life for every relationship, friendship, situationship, whatever it is. Don't lie to me. Don't waste my time. And don't have me looking crazy in these streets.
Don't have you looking crazy in the streets?
Yeah.
Okay.
So you break any one of those rules, it's probably pretty much done.
It's pretty much done?
Yeah. Huh. Yeah, don't have me looking crazy in these streets. Like, just don't do it.
Right.
If you did some stuff you ain't got no business doing, you might as well just go ahead and tell me. Because if I find out, now I'm out here and somebody telling me something I don't know, you got me looking crazy in these streets.
Crazy in the streets. Got it. Makes sense.
Tanya agrees with you about the same, arguing about the same thing over and over again. Yeah, inconsistency is like one of the biggest issues that I think that most women face dating in 2022. Why are men so inconsistent? Men, you here? Tell us. Why are y'all so inconsistent?
Why are men so inconsistent? Let's see. Why are men so inconsistent? Well, I don't know. It depends on what a woman is asking, what a man is inconsistent about. It just all depends. Sometimes inconsistency depends upon what exactly are you accusing me of being inconsistent about? How about that? Answer that question. Let's start dating.
Buckshot says, nowadays, women are inconsistent. Okay, we can talk about that too. But usually inconsistency comes with things like, I'm going to call you later. We're going to do this weekend. Let's talk this afternoon. And then you don't hear from them for days. Or they don't show up when they say they're going to show up. They don't call when they say they're going to call. Just inconsistent. You calling me, you DMing me, you telling me how much you're interested in me, how bad you want me, the shit y'all say. How bad you want me, how beautiful I am, blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, okay. And then I don't hear from you again for another 2 weeks. You back with the same shit again. When you gonna go out with me? Okay, I'll go out with you. It's just the same shit. It's like a never-ending cycle. Like, what are we doing?
Okay.
Mama B says, I pay attention to how people act versus what they say. When people want you to see themselves a certain way or respect them when they don't even live by their own word. Nitra says, they say one thing and do another. Sometimes it don't matter how you plan things out with men, they still drop the ball. Miss New Vintage says, not calling or texting. Little Buckshot says that stuff goes both ways. Okay, Buckshot, I've heard you, and we're going to talk about that. But first, Paul is going to help us, or you men can help us. What is this inconsistent? Now that you have a better idea what inconsistency means, what is that about?
Well, I always put myself out there. For me, it just all depends on, I guess, a lot of times, like what I have. So I am famous, infamous for saying, I'm gonna call you back. I tell you, you already know. Like I call you back, nigga, but that shit might not be today. It might not be till tomorrow, might not be. Because sometimes I literally, and I'm not trying to make excuses, but sometimes it just be like that. Like I'm from one job to the next, and if I say I'm gonna call you back, sometimes I think at that moment I'm gonna have time to call you back, but then shit, I'm on to the next, and then next thing I know, shit, fucking hours have gone by, and I'm like, fuck, I forgot to call or text, and then by that time I've already gotten a text message. Oh, but I thought you was gonna call me back. Well, you could at least call me. And then my famous line from women, nigga, it only takes 2.5 seconds to pick up the fucking phone and call somebody else. Listen, I get it. I know. And I would say that I don't think I do it intentionally, but sometimes my inconsistency may come from, I don't know, maybe the energy you're giving me. Like if we talking about some shit and then we get into it and I say I'm gonna call you back, but we've gotten to some kind of little spat through a text message. Yeah, then I'm probably gonna be inconsistent because I'm probably like don't want to talk to your ass for a couple of days because I'm pissed the fuck off. Just that simple.
Now, Mama B brings up another inconsistency. Let's talk about this one. You act one way for the world, but be fake to me behind closed doors. So behind closed doors, I'm your baby. You love me. You want to be with me. Blah blah blah. But you know, to the world, I don't know that bitch. We just kicking it.
I don't think men do that.
Do they? It? Definitely do that. Men definitely downplay the relationship to everybody else, and then to you, make them like you the whole world. They definitely do that.
You know, I don't think it's like that. I think that's how women perceive it to be, because like so. For instance, perfect example. So women will say that shit in a case like if a nigga don't want to post you on social media or say something about you personally on social media, then it's like, oh, nigga, why you downplaying me to the fucking world? Like, nigga, what? That's more what women say. Like if a nigga, oh, you can't post me on your Instagram. You can't post me on Facebook. Like the fuck? Like I could, but I'm not. Nope. Ain't gonna do it, and I'm not gonna feel some kind of way because I don't. But that's just me. And it's not like somebody's like quote unquote trying to downplay you. But like right now, we live in a world of social media. We live in a world where Facebook is now the new Bible, and Instagram is the Holy Quran. So I just think that too many people sometimes put too much fucking emphasis and faith and shit on Instagram and Facebook, and it's like I don't need a whole bunch of motherfucking angry ass, salty ass people in my personal business. Then you tell a woman that, then it's like, oh no, nigga.
Oh yeah, because y'all are just private. But let me just tell you, it's a difference between being private and being a secret.
Okay. Damn, you have no more vivations left.
Lies. Don't even worry about it. Don't even worry about it.
Okay, well, my bad. Okay, I mean, I didn't even know you got a second bottle. Got that? That's.
So this is the one I used from last time, so I didn't finish it.
Oh, okay.
Nitra says, back to what you were saying earlier, she says, why not just tell the person I'm upset and won't be talking to you for a few days instead of just falling off and the person not know what the hell is going on?
For me, I could do that, right? I could do that. But a lot of times for me, people know me for the most part. Like people who've dealt with me, they know me. They know
but
me.
But why should they have to know you? We're adults. We're adults.
What I'm saying is they know people because I communicate. Everybody communicates differently. That's how I communicate. My communication is not communication sometimes. Like if I don't fucking talk to you for a couple of days and you were in the text message when I was in the text message, so you already know it's about to be some smoke. So like I'm cool. I'm going to let you keep that smoke over there. I'm going to go back over in this corner. I'm going to sit in my corner. You know what it is. Like, because I don't feel like I have to sit there and baby you and walk you through shit all the time. Nigga, you know what you did. You know how you came at me. You know how you meant it. So I'm going
to
go ahead and.
That's not babying or walking through to say, look, you nigga, you know what you did. You know how you did me. I'm going to need a few days to cool off. Like, how hard is that to say?
I don't have to say all that because you already know. So I don't want, you don't want this. I don't feel like I got to say all that. You know what it is. Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and be in my corner for a minute. That's just me.
Mama B says, don't hide me. I don't like that. If you're not happy to be with me, leave me where I'm at. So that goes back to what we were talking about, how but here's the thing. I hear what you're saying about social media, and everybody's a little different about social media. But don't call me your boo and your bae behind closed doors, and then you run into somebody you know while we out, and it's like, oh, this, like, it's hesitant, like, oh, this my friend Ebony. If I'm your boo and your bae, why is it now all of a sudden we just became good friends after lunch?
Well, I don't know no instance where niggas, I mean, there could be niggas who do that, but I don't really see niggas doing that. Like, I don't see niggas like be out in public, nigga out in public. Like, oh, that's just
you don't see. Just, maybe you don't see niggas your age doing that.
Well, but they do.
They do.
I don't see niggas my age doing no shit like that. If I'm out with you and somebody, you know what I'm saying, you know, whatever. I don't know. I don't know. Maybe younger niggas do that shit. I don't know. Now, I will say I'm the type of person, like, if I'm in a relationship with you and I'm kicking with you, like, I'm not the nigga that's going to sit. You're not going to see me on my Instagram page, like, with me and the person I'm dealing with, posted up, posting pictures. Oh, we here at the fucking whatever the fuck. Nah, I'm not doing all that shit because it's none of your fucking business. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes I feel like a moment that I might be sharing with my special person, that's between me and that fucking person. I don't need to share. Because I already share enough of my life with the world as it is, whether it be from my boxing shit, from whether it be just, I mean, hell, the radio station shit. So my personal intimate moments, I don't need to share that with the fucking whole world all the fucking time. And if a person I'm dating feels like they have to be publicized in that light all the time, then I don't know. Like, the
fuck? You keep saying all the time. Is there ever a time that you do that?
I mean, it could be, but the fuck, why? But we have to ask ourselves, why are we really doing it? Like, what are you really trying to do? Like, the fuck?
I mean, I can, like, when I post pictures of me and Brian, right? I'm not trying to do anything. I'm just posting a picture of me and my bae. I love him. I'm happy that we're together. We're having a good time. We took a cool picture, right?
Oh, okay.
Now, let me tell you. I will tell you that this was a struggle for me and Brian early on in our relationship. And, you know, I did have to sit back and, like, ask myself, how important is this social media shit, right? But ultimately, it makes us feel like we're a little secret, right? It makes us feel like you don't want, there's somebody you don't want to know that we're together or how you feel about me. So, you know, well, Brian kind of said some of the same things you said. I'm pretty private. If you notice on my social media, I don't post personal shit, period. He was like, then he said the thing that made me be like, okay. He says, I don't even post pictures of myself. So then I was like, okay, he has a point there, right? He does have a point there. So what I said was, okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to stop posting then, right? Because again, as a woman, you're doing all the posting your man here, posting your man there, declaring your love and stuff. And he never does any of it in return, not in return, but he never does any of it on his page. Now it's just starting to look like you're kind of delusional, right? You know, people on the outside look at it is like, do this nigga even feel the same way about her? Because I don't see her nowhere on his page. That's just what we do. Right?
Right.
So I was like, you know what? I'm going to pull back and I'm just not going to post him on my page at all. Right? If that's what we're doing, we're agreeing. We want to be private. It's not our thing. I'm not going to do it. Right? So then I don't know if he noticed that or if he felt the tension. So then, you know, out the blue, Brian would just put a post up about how much he loved me, this, that, and the third. And I would just be like, oh my God. You know what I mean? So, but now he's kind of back to, he doesn't really post at all much anymore. But whether we want to admit it or not, whether we want to say it's just social media or not, like, it's the day and age that we live in, right? So I think it's kind of ludicrous to be like, well, why do we care about Facebook? You care about Facebook any other fucking day. Like, what? Why, when it comes to me, do we not care about Facebook?
Well, for me, again, that's just not something that I have ever That is just something that I haven't that I've that I haven't that I haven't that I haven't done. Like, I just haven't done it. And to the so much to the point where I don't even know how many people actually have, I mean, this, I'm not gonna say no one, but I don't even know how many people actually have a actual picture of me. Like, they might have a, like a, you know what I mean? Like, I'm just like, especially like of me and that person like together. Like, I don't really do pictures. Like,
Oh, so you
I
won't
don't
even
really.
take the picture. You got too much shit to hide. Let me read some of these comments while you while
Like,
we
it ain't even
while
nothing about, I don't do that kind of shit. Like, listen,
Okay, let
I
me
don't.
read some of these comments. Tanya asked back when you were saying what you were saying. She says, "Do you wait for someone to text you first if you don't talk for a few days? Or do you, when you're finished with your time off, do you go ahead and hit them up and be like, I'm ready now?"
Yeah, usually, like, after I've gone about a day or two, or whatever, I have a feel. And then it will also depend on what we were actually arguing about. I mean, if it was something that just, kind of ruffled my feathers or got on my skin type shit or whatever, you know what I mean? Then I'll hit you back, the next, maybe not the next day, but the day after that or something like that. But if it's ever been something where I'm as one of the deal breaker type of situations, like, no, you might not get a text back at all. There's a wrap after that. I'm good.
First Class Boxer says communication is key, but the terms for communication have to be understood from the beginning. Miss New, I'm trying to understand where these comments came from. That's why Miss New Vintage says exactly low key shady. And that's when I was talking about the situation where you might run into somebody and you don't really introduce the person as your boo or your bae or whatever. They say, I agree with that. None of their business. Mama B says, I don't care about social media. I mean face to face. So she says, I don't post no nigga. First Class Boxer says, just because I don't post you doesn't mean I don't appreciate or approve of you. If you're mine, you're mine. Mama B agrees. First Class Boxer says social media has become too toxic to where a post means I quote unquote love you. I do think that sometimes we do put too much stock into social media, and posts and things like that. I don't know. I'm kind of 50-50 on that. I definitely know that like just because you make a post doesn't mean that, you know, this thing is solid as a rock or whatever. You know what I mean? I'm definitely aware of that. I really just think it's more about, and it depends on like, so Mama B is saying she don't post no nigga, but Mama B also doesn't post on her social media a whole ton of a lot, right? So I think it just kind of depends on like your activity on social media. Like if you're one of those people that's always posting, it's all, you know what I mean? Then it becomes a thing where you just kind of like, it would be nice, you know what I mean, to be acknowledged for people to know I'm your lady, right? But so there are a lot of variables to me when it comes to social media. But I definitely don't think that it's the end all be all because I've seen people post, I laid with a nigga before that, you know, was posting his wife and how much she loved him, how much she meant to him, but he was laid up with me. So like, you know what I mean? I'm not saying that it's like, oh, it's the definite, you know, but I think for a lot of women, it just is like, you know, it makes us feel like you're proud to tell everybody that I'm your lady, right? And so conversely, if you don't do that, it kind of makes us think,
Right,
who is
but you're saying that it makes women feel for proud to say that you're your lady. But to who? To a bunch of people that you really don't even interact with any motherfucking way? And the people who you do know on social media, they already know y'all situation. They already know y'all in love. They know those are the people that really know what it is. So, to who? To the rest of the world? To a bunch of people who just friend requested you, who just want to be on your friends list? I don't even know half of those people. So it doesn't even make sense that you would need approval from people who don't.
It's not approval. I think that we're using the wrong wording. It's not approval. Again, it just makes us feel like you would tell the world. It's like when men used to say back in the day, I'll tell the world, I'll shout it from the mountaintops or whatever. It's kind of the same feeling, I guess, that makes a woman feel like he doesn't mind telling whoever that I'm.
And I think that was pretty much a wrong analogy to say I'll shout it from the mountaintop. Because if you really think that through and think about it literally, at the top of a mountain, ain't nobody up there, motherfucker. Ain't nobody going to hear me anyway. It's just me and you, baby. We just up here by ourselves anyway at the top of this mountain. Who the hell is at the top of the mountain?
I didn't make up the saying.
I'm just saying. That's a dumbass analogy. Maybe I'm going to go to at the top of the mountain. Ain't nobody up there but you and me anyway. Ain't nobody down below going to hear us. So that's how we keep it, just between me and you. That's what we do. Yeah, baby.
Owen says you don't need social media to validate your relationship. And I agree. I totally agree with that. If you're relying only on social media, something's wrong. Flips and Design says, there's pros and cons to posting your bae. What if you break up? Do you then go and delete all those pictures? So here's the thing. For me, I haven't really ever just posted any and every dude that I ever dated. You know what I mean? So I didn't really have, you know, any whole lot of pictures to delete. I initially did not delete any of those pictures because, you know what I mean? I feel like I date grown, mature men that know that they weren't the first man that I've ever been with, right? So, you know, it doesn't make sense for them to say, why is this picture on your page? What's the date on it? Like, do you really think I'm about to go back? Like, you know, so I've never had that problem. I know that people have had that problem where, like, the new man now wants you to go take all your pictures down on the last man. Ain't nobody got time for that. And I've never asked a dude to do that either. You don't have to take down pictures of anything that happened before Ebony. Like, that's dumb. I did delete all the pictures of my ex-husband just because I didn't want the fucking memories, right? I didn't want them to keep coming up in my memories. I didn't want to keep seeing them. So I was like, delete. Like, I just don't want to be bothered with it. And we do all know that person that seems like every year they posting up with another nigga, right? Or another woman. It's like, weren't you just, you know what I'm saying? The last, how many soulmates you get? So I get that too. So I definitely think you have to be selective. And how you are going to be that selective, I don't know. I don't know. First Class Boxer says, my page is boxing. If it doesn't relate to what I'm doing in my career or match to it, the objective from my social media is obvious. Well, see, that's a whole different thing, right? It would be crazy. If all you ever post about is stuff for boxing, it would be crazy for your lady to be like, how come you never post me? So you did well, I guess. That's an easy one. Mama B says, I could care less what people have to say, especially if you aren't a part of my life. China says, I totally agree. Miss New Vintage says, it's acceptance. When I was talking about how a woman, you know, feels about you posting her, she said acceptance. Roz says, I think if you were in a relationship where you're dealt with infidelity, that may be a gesture to aid in a sense of security for the other partner. Owen says, I don't delete my pics. That was my life, and it was the past. Period. I kind of agree. Like, you know what I mean? Sneezy says, if we're dating, posting a picture is not a big deal. But if he's my husband, then there shouldn't be an issue.
Oh, well. I mean, you know, to each.
Well, you know what? And when it comes to, like, social media, it's such a thing, right? Because even when, Facebook has a thing where you can say, like, you're in a relationship with or you're married to so-and-so. And even that can become, like, a whole thing if you're not willing to do that, right?
Oh, yeah, I am.
First Class Boxer says, I'd rather delete my social media before I go back and forth about you feeling insecure about a relationship due to social media. I'll just get rid of it to avoid further issues. Now, that's a whole different topic, right? The whole different topic about that is, would you delete social media if your partner asked you to, or if it made them feel more comfortable? For me, it's a no. Because in my mind, we got bigger issues than social media if that's what you're asking me to do.
If you mean to tell me our whole relationship hinges on the fact on whether I have social media or not, then we ain't gonna make it anyway. We ain't even gonna get out the blocks, boo boo. So you might as well go ahead and you might go ahead and want to take cover now and get on.
Nitra says, if your mate posting your pics on social media is what validates your relationship, then that's so elementary. Ross says, when I was engaged, my fiance asked me to delete pics of my ex from college. And I said no, because that was a part of my past. And I wasn't about to sit there and delete all that. College, though, like, who is that insecure, right? That they want you to delete pictures of people you were with in college. Like, that sounds like nonsense and foolishness to me. Malvi says, if my love is based on how I do or don't post you on my social media, it's not for me. Flips and Design says, I know someone that never posted about their significant other until they were married. No one even knew he was even dating or seeing anyone. Yeah, I don't think that I posted about Brian until we were engaged. So in my entire life of social media, I've only posted three men. My ex-husband, my ex-fiance, and Brian. I'm just not one like to post a picture every time I went out on a date with somebody. Now, you may see a picture with me and another dude in a mixture of other pictures. Like, right, if we were all out, you know, doing something, you can assume whatever you want from those pictures of me and that dude. But I've never posted, like, you know, me and that dude out on a date with no long post about this is what we're doing. I just, you know, it hasn't been my thing.
I've never done it. I've just never done it. I'm just never done it. I don't even, to be honest with you, I don't even really like social media like that for real. I just, especially as far as the posting of the pictures thing, you know what I'm saying? It's hard for me to even sometimes fathom, like, seriously, like, people, even with Tickety Talk and all this other stuff, like, I try to sometimes get into this new wave of shit, but I'm like, who the fuck has that much time to be doing that shit all day? Like, I don't get it. I don't get it. I can't do it.
That's how come I can't get into Twitter, right? Because Twitter is the one that I feel like you have to do all day. I got one post. Like, you know what I mean? So Twitter is something I never could get into because I just was like, I don't have that much to say that often. Ross says, yeah, I've only posted my college ex since it was a 3-year relationship. And then my husband at the time I posted, that's it. Sneezy says, I dated someone who wanted me to take my prom picture down. We argued about it so many times, it was crazy. Like, what type of insecure individual is that? That wants you to take your prom picture down. That is a bigger issue. That's what I'm saying. Sometimes social media will show you that there's some deeper issues than you thought. First Class Boxer says, social media is not meant for everyone to know my every move. I'm private already, so when you see me pop out in what seems new to you, I'm doing my job. I'm protecting my peace.
Absolutely. That's how I feel. Like, I don't like people in my, I mean, is it, my thing is this. Well, I've even heard people tell me, like, never mind. Never mind.
Pretty Driven says, I'm always single on social media. Look, Pretty Driven, I used to have a meme that says that on my social media, one day you might think I'm married, single, prostituting, homeless, whatever. You will never know. Based upon my social media, like First Class Boxer said, my every move and what I got going on.
Yeah.
Unless it's just something I want to share. And a lot of times, I don't usually share it in the moment, right? So I'm not one of those people that, like, you know, as soon as I take the picture, I have to put it on social media in that moment. I might not put that picture up for another 3 weeks just because I'm going through my phone. I'm like, oh, that was a cute picture. Let me throw that on Instagram. Because like you said, Paul, I have that same problem with Instagram, right? I just be like, I haven't posted on Instagram in a couple of weeks. You're supposed to put pictures on Instagram.
Right. Sometimes, yeah. Like, even sometimes, like, I'll go in and I'll post stuff or whatever, like, every day for a while. When I first started, even the radio show page. But then after a while, I just got tired. I'm like, it's exhausting to sit there and try to post something like every single day. So I don't do it. I don't do it.
I don't know. I didn't know. I don't know. Social media is real tricky. You know what I mean? I think it's, and again, I think it just like, so First Class Boxer saying, if I saw that all you ever post is boxing shit, why would I say, how come you never post me? Like, you know what I mean? Like, sometimes you gotta just read the room, right? Pay attention to what they're doing. But if you know you're dealing with somebody who's always posting pictures of himself out, because there are dudes out there like that, right? We always try to say it's a female thing, but there are definitely dudes out here that are always posting about where they're going, what they're doing, who they're doing it with, what they bought, how much money they shoes they bought. I see it all over social media all the time. They post right. The shoes they bought and the trips they on. So like, if you're dealing with somebody like that, then it is seem a little odd that you're saying that I'm the one. And you can't post no pictures of us.
Right. The only time I will ever, I have posted things like in the moment, like right then and there, is like my students. Like if we're at a boxing match or something like that, like it's in the moment, I'll record.
Well, that's live, though. That's when you go live, right?
Yeah, and I'll go live or something like that. But yeah. Other than that, just like my own personal life, I'm not going to do that.
Flips and Design says, I have such a love-hate relationship with social media and divorce it often. Listen, I definitely think that, like, I have periods where I'm just like, you know what, I'm logging off, right? I think what social media has probably become, for me especially, is just entertainment, right? Like when I'm bored, let me get on here and see what's going on. You know what I mean? But I'm kind of like you, Flips and Designs. I have a love-hate relationship. I do think that it's an excellent means of, like, getting word out to people. And, you know, it's an excellent means of advertising. I think it's an excellent means. It just depends to me on how you use it, I guess. I think it's an excellent means of, like, communicating with family that doesn't live nearby and, you know, that kind of thing. And I'm not really the type of person. Like, I have a friend, I swear she posts pictures of herself every day. And I'm just like, why? Like, who does that? You know what I mean? But if that's your thing, that's your thing. I think people should do what makes them happy. But I don't have that type of thing.
Yeah, I will say this snazzy radio station we got though would be popping. So I'd be on that though. I like that.
Did you see what I put on my story today to advertise?
No, I didn't.
Oh, you gotta
no,
look at it. It's nope. Hot.
Nope, I'm not gonna do it. Now I'll go look at it later, but I didn't even see it. I ain't see it.
One Scorpio Chica says, I post all kinds of stuff and loads of people on and off. I love to post quotes. Mama B says, I'll delete social media in a heartbeat. Yeah, you know, I go through phases, right? So I usually, generally, what I try to use, particularly my Facebook page for, is I generally try to use it to be positive, to post like One Scorpio Chica says, you know, quotes, whether they're encouraging, whether they're funny. That's generally what I do on social media. When I first got Facebook, I think I probably posted way more like personal, I'm in my feelings type of shit on Facebook. And then I just kind of, you know, move past that where it's like, every fucking body don't need to know you're depressed this week. You know what I mean? So I usually stick to like quotes and funny pictures, memes. If something happens to happen or whatever, and I took some cute pictures, I may post them. Instagram is only pictures, so I think it can become a little bit harder for me sometimes. Then I have a thing where, like, it's probably my personal thing, where I don't want to post the same shit everywhere because I feel like the same people who follow me on IG follow me on
the
Facebook.
Same shit anyway. Yeah.
So if I put it on Facebook, I don't put it on IG and vice versa. And now with the whole Miss Hot Topic thing, I am like worn out because I now have two Facebook pages. Well, I actually have three Facebook pages, but one of the Facebook pages, when I initially created it, I was like, you know what? This is going to be my free for all. I'm going to post whatever the hell I want to. Cause you know, on my regular page, I got church folks and pastors and, you know, I got a little lifestyle people. I got a little bit of everybody, you know, family. And so I don't use that second Facebook page, but I got a Miss Hot Topic Facebook page. And like you said, it can be exhausting trying to make sure you post in all the places that you got social media every day. So I don't.
This is true.
I don't have energy for that. One Scorpio Chica says, oh, and I post selfies, especially when I'm not in a good headspace. Listen, then I got Snapchat. All my social media I got because my kids got it, right? In my mind, if my kids were there, that's where I needed to be. So I run into so many parents that don't even know how Snapchat works, right? So how the hell you know what your kids are doing on Snapchat and you don't even know how it works? So you don't even know that there's a private area for pictures and shit like that. So that's why I got all my social media. But that's why I love Snapchat, One Scorpio Chica, right? Because if I'm having a bad day or a not so cute day, I just go on Snapchat and play with all the filters and snap pictures. And it makes me feel better. Like,
so let's do this though. I wanna, I still wanna go through, like, you and I have shared as far as deal breakers for us, but I wanna hear some from the audience, like some more deal breakers for them. Like, what deal breakers do they have? Like, what's an absolute no go for them in their relationship? I wanna know.
Mama B said one of her deal breakers was acting one way in public and then differently in private.
Okay.
Tanya said that one of her deal breakers was multiple cheating.
Okay.
Let's see what other people say about their deal breakers. Oh, I promised Buckshot that we would go back to.
You did say that. Yeah, you did.
What were we talking about that I promised him we would go back to?
I don't remember. It's so far back. I think something about, I don't know, something involving you.
No, it wasn't me. It was something when we were talking about the cheating thing, I thought.
Hi, Brianna. Hi, baby.
Miss New Vintage says smoking, hygiene, making assumptions.
Oh. Okay. Yeah.
Tanya says, you can add leaving my text on red as a deal breaker. Miss Vintage added, asking someone for money after knowing them less than 3 weeks. Asking someone for money after 3 weeks. You need to know me way longer than 3 weeks before you ask me for some money.
Right.
Yes. Somebody, I don't remember who it was. Thank you, Mama B. Somebody else on our, who one of our viewers added inconsistency as one of their deal breakers. Flips and Design says cheating, inconsistency, broken promises and plans, which is inconsistency, lacking in communication. This list could go on and on. One Scorpio Chica says poor hygiene. So clearly poor hygiene is more of a thing than we want to admit. Just saying.
I mean, who the fuck is showing up stinking and shit? Like, I don't even understand that. Like, how do you even get to the shit? Like, you know what I mean? Like, if somebody's you know what I mean? Like, got poor hygiene.
And Flips and Designs, I'm with you. The communication is a thing for me. Like, if you are unable to communicate and we can't talk and like adults, like, that's probably going to be a deal breaker for me. Like, how are we going to ever get through anything, deal with anything, if we can't even have a conversation?
Yeah, communication is always like the top of the, you know, I think sometimes we're just bad at communicating, period. On both sides of the fence, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I agree. It is on both sides of the fence. Sneezy, you know, says a person who doesn't take care of their child. Mama B says deadbeats. Ooh. Nitra says, so you don't know a person that has poor hygiene before taking the relationship to the next level. So yeah, because here's the thing: what happens? You know what I mean? You don't really know if they have poor hygiene until. Because it's not like they have poor hygiene to the point where, like, you can smell them across the room or at the dinner table, right? But once you're, like, laying up with them for a few days, you realize this bitch ain't showered for the last 2 days, 3 days, you know what I mean? Or you get home from the club and they just want to go right into being nasty. Like, we not gonna wash up. We've been sweating on the dance floor all night. Like, it's little things like that for me. First class boxer says, not respecting the fact that I'm a busy man. I am a jack of all trades. I don't stay put. If you can't respect the hustle I have going for myself, I could be too much for her to handle. Mm-hmm. And I'm a whole dad first and foremost. Yeah. Now, you know, and first class boxer, that's interesting because that's always like a double-edged sword, right? Because we always want a man who has money, who can pay the bills, who can take care of you, this, that, and the third. But at the same time, now you're complaining, he don't spend no time with me. We don't never, but how, he out here hustling. He out here making it happen, right? So he don't have hours to lay up on the phone with you.
Trust me.
And be with you. So it's always a double-edged sword because we want both, right?
You can't get both. I mean,
I have always said that you really only have that problem when you don't have a life of your own, right? I believe when you don't have a life of your own, that's when it becomes far more prevalent to you and you're far more needy as far as like time and stuff like that. But if you got shit going on in your own life, it doesn't bother you as much if you haven't seen him in 3 days because you're doing your own shit anyway. You've been busy your damn self, right?
Right.
You were going to say something? I was going to read some more comments. Okay. What were you going to say?
No, I wasn't saying nothing.
Huh?
I wasn't saying anything. I was adjusting myself.
Pretty Driven says, bringing up sex too early.
What? I'm like,
talking about
is that a thing?
That is a thing. That is a thing. A dude is in your inbox texting you whatever, and 3 days into the conversation, he already, so what's your favorite position? Nigga, what?
Is that not a fair question?
Not on the third day. No.
Why not?
You need to get to know me a little. At least pretend like you want to get to know me a little.
Why? Because
unless you tell me up front that really all I'm trying to do is fuck you, then that's a problem. Now, if you told me up front.
Really?
Yes. Oh. Now, if you told me up front, I am looking for a relationship. I just want to have a good time. Then maybe by the third day, I'd be like, all right, well, you know. But no, don't come at me like I'm so interested in you. I want to take you out. I want to wine and dine you. I want to see where this can go. And then 2 days later, send me a naked picture. Like, what?
No. No. Okay. I mean, all right. I get it. Too early. All right. Don't ask too early. Got it.
One Scorpio. Oh, wait. My comments moved. Roz says, someone that lacks ambition or makes a ton of excuses. Also, someone with a really negative outlook. I agree, Roz. Like, I just don't feel like I could be with anybody that just is negative about everything. Like, nigga, like, you're blowing me right now. So, yeah, I definitely think that's a thing. One Scorpio says, maybe not hygiene, but bad habits and not taking care of yourself. Disrespectful, poor work ethic. Sneezy says, someone who is possessive. Because there's a difference between being possessive and territorial.
That's true.
Pretty Driven. Ross says, I can't believe, Ross says, heck yes, it's a thing. Do you really not think that's a thing about people bringing up sex too early?
No.
Why?
I don't know. I just didn't know it was a thing. Just like shit. I just like, you know, a couple shows ago, shit. I didn't know that, you know, that.
But it's more so how you present yourself.
Excuse me. My son is also, he heard the conversation and he feels like he needs to add his 2 cents. Mm-hmm. our guest tonight is. If your daughter gets to be here, my son gets to be here.
I was gonna say something good.
Mama B says, if we talk about sex, it's a turnoff because now my mind is on just fucking. And if that's what we're doing, that's cool, but let's establish that from the beginning. Don't come with all these false pretenses if all you want to do is fuck. Then just say that.
And it's more so.
Okay, so what I'm saying is,
I think it's going to react in that way.
My son said, ladies, that it's also in how we present ourselves. So if you're posting half-naked pictures on your social media, then the dude is going to slide up and try to ask you questions about sex and stuff. So we need to be more cognizant of the type of pictures that we post. Pretty Driven said exactly.
That's literally what it is.
Ron says, I had a first date and the guy was doing the absolute most. Tanya says, no dick pics.
Especially if it's not X. Like, if anybody says doing that.
Ron said, go grab your phone and join the live.
On my phone?
Oh. Now he got his phone, Ross. Thank you. Instagram. On this Hot Topic.
But yeah, I just didn't know that it was
Nitra said, your son made a good point. It really is a good point. And I think, ladies, we often don't talk about this enough because we're in this culture, we're in this Me Too culture, right? And yes, no woman deserves to be raped based upon how she's dressed or anything like that. But at the same time, ladies, why is it that we feel like we can post half-naked pictures and we can be twerking and stuff like that on IG and then be offended that a dude comes at you sexually? Like, to me, that make it make sense.
I mean, that's definitely true. I would definitely say that if you are on your page and you're twerking, if you're on your page, you know, very scantily dressed, you're probably going to get more, you're definitely probably going to get more more attention to your inbox. And it's probably going to be unsolicited dick pics and it's probably going to be a whole bunch of other shit. You know what I'm saying?
And it's thirst trapping. To me, it's just like somebody said, I think Nitra said, thirst trapping. Like, you just need some attention. But then you can't be mad at the type of attention that you get. You know what I mean?
Right. And then sometimes we as men, I mean, it's definitely, you know, if you're thirst trapping, you're going to get some dick pics. And don't get mad when you do. You know what I'm saying? And then women always want to say, well, just because I dress this way doesn't mean I want your dick pic in my inbox. Well, okay. Well, I'm not saying that you do, but more times than not, that's probably what's going to happen. You know what I'm saying? No one's probably going to say, hey, can we go to the movies? Most people might say, hey, can you twerk that ass on this dick? You're probably going to get a message like that. You know what I mean? But sometimes a woman can just be attractive and she still could get a dick pic.
Sometimes a woman can just be attractive. But Mama B says, don't build up a fake relationship. If all you want from me is sex, I'll respect you more if you're honest with me about your intentions. Now, women, I hear women say this all the time. I say it all the time. For whatever reason, men have a hard time believing this. Now, let me be clear. Just because you say that's all I want doesn't mean that's all I'm willing to give. But like Mama B said, I will respect you enough, be like, well, damn, at least you told me the truth. It's still my option, my right to say, yeah, I'm not really looking for just a sexual relationship. But because y'all want the pussy so bad, y'all are willing to just lie and build up this fake relationship to get the pussy. How does that make sense?
Excuse me? Say that one more time. Fake relationship. What?
Yes. Y'all are willing to lie. Y'all are willing to, you know, I just want to be with you. I think you're so beautiful. You smart. You this, you that. How's your day? They checking on you and how you feel. They acting like they so interested in you and who you are and what's going on with you. And all they really trying to do is get in the draws, right? But why not? We kind of skip the whole shit.
Okay, but then hold on. You say that, but then somebody just said not too long ago that bringing up sex too early is a turnoff. So it's like,
not bringing up sex too early is not a turnoff if all you want is sex, right? So let me know up front all you want is sex. Then I can let you know
Listen. Let's. Oh my God, I don't even want to do this shit. But let's. Oh my God, listen. Okay, lady. Let me clear something up.
Why are you so vexed over there? What's going on?
let me clear something up for ladies, okay? So maybe ladies don't quite understand. Maybe y'all understand, but y'all really don't want to understand. Okay, understand this. Ready? This may sound shocking to some women, and I get it. But here's the thing. 9 times out of 10, okay? Probably in most cases, 10 times out of 10. If I'm talking to you, if I've tried to get your attention, it's because I want to fuck. Period. Whether I say it the first day, the second day, the third, fourth, or fifth day, I've already reached out to you because I find you attractive. I find you attractive enough that I want to fuck. Period. That's just what it is. Now,
listen, hold on. I'm not talking about you ultimately want to fuck, because we know that ultimately you want to fuck. I'm talking about if you know up front that all you want to do is fuck, right? Because sometimes you're in a space where you're not really looking to be in a relationship. I just want to fuck you.
Right. So, but that's not always the case. That's not always the case. Meaning, you might be in a space that, yes, I'm looking at this chick, I want to smash or whatever. But it's usually what happens after I fuck you is what's going to determine what space you end up being in.
Okay, my son commented, because y'all wouldn't let him come on. And he says, wait, where'd it go? He says, 24/7 Noah says, you are what you present yourself as. Be a lady and be treated like one. Act like a hoe and you'll get that response. First Class Boxer said, it's one thing to be sexy but sophisticated. Exactly. And I definitely agree, right? Let me see. Sneezy says, guys be thirst trapping also, gray sweatpants. Yeah, but usually when those guys do that, they okay with a woman throwing a pussy pick in their box, right? They don't struggle with that. They don't, guys who are posting thirst trap pictures do not get a pussy or tits in their inbox and be like, I can't believe this bitch sent this to me. Why was she sending me something like this? They just don't feel the same way we do. Tanya says, I agree a little, because when you first meet someone, it's based on physical appearance.
It's physical shit. When you first meet somebody, I have never in the history of never seen any woman, and I'm like, oh my God, man. Woo! I can't motherfucking wait to find. No, nigga, we don't do that. Like, when I see you, I'm like, damn, she fine. She can get it. And then after I have that thought, right? I'm going to go over and talk to you, approach you. And then, like, that's when the conversation starts. Then you find out, can she form a full sentence? Does she use all of her vowels? And when I say that, people be thinking that shit's funny, but, like, can she form a full fucking sentence? You get what I'm saying? It's a lot of things. So it's like, sometimes it's like, you can't be mad at a man because we find you sexually attractive. Like, you're like, yeah, I give it to her. Like, yeah, she could get this work. Oh, you can get this work, but it doesn't always mean that I just, and there will be nothing else, but it's typically what makes that happen is after I have a conversation with you, like for instance, I can look at you and say, oh, you fine. Oh, well, damn, she's fine, right? I can say to myself, yeah, I want to hit that. Now what? Now once we start talking, have a conversation with you, okay, she got some brain. Okay, she used all her vows. Okay, and then you start fact-finding some other things. So then you say to yourself, I still want to hit it, but I might want to talk to her a little bit more. But then there's some chicks that you start talking to them like, yeah, I'm just going to fuck this one. I'm just going to hit it. I'm just like this. I want to hit, but
Mama B said it best. Truth is, women think about sex just as much as men do. We just say, be honest about it. Right. If you think that as women, we look at men and be like, I sure would like to be in a relationship with him. Nah, we look at exactly. niggas and we like, that nigga is fine. I will fuck him, right? We do the same shit.
And exactly.
All I'm saying is that our approach is very different. Most women, unless that's, I mean, some women are honest enough to be like, yo, I want to fuck you, right? But most women don't approach a man and immediately start talking about sex, right? Even though in our minds we like, oh my God, did you see that?
What? Different? Hold on, wait, say that again. You most don't think women?
Most women don't approach men and immediately start talking about sex.
Shit.
So you get a lot of women come to you about sex?
Shit. Nigga, stop playing. Are you kidding me? Listen, this is like 2022. This is not 1822. Women nowadays be like, listen, hold on, time out. A couple shows ago, I just found out that me could have been just dick. So don't come in. Yeah. So,
oh, yeah. Yes. Well, that's true. He said he just found out he could have been. Are we still talking about that?
I could have just been dick to somebody. You know what I'm saying? Or sometimes women will be, perfect example. Sometimes women will be in a space where they could have been like in a long-term relationship, right? They could have been married for a long time or just whatever. And they never really had the opportunity to just be out there, just date, just do their thing. So they'll be like, listen, I like you. I probably would give you this pussy, but yeah, nigga, you just probably might not be the only nigga I'm dating. I said I'm out here fucking everybody, but that's just the space I'm in right now.
Yeah, but that's the thing. Women are usually way more honest about that up front, right? Women are usually way more honest up front about saying, I ain't really trying to be tied down.
Nah.
I just want to do my thing. I want to have a good time. We're way more honest about that up front. And here's the other thing. It's the same thing with women. I know you've heard before that women usually know up front whether they want to fuck you or not, right? So it's the same thing. We see a man, he looks good, he like, you like shit, and then he talk, right? Whatever he say in those first few conversations determines whether we're going to fuck him or not, right? We know right away, based upon, like you said, can he string some sentences together? Can he think clearly? We know right away, most women don't fuck men that we don't feel like can at least we can have a conversation with, right? Most women don't just be like, well, he fine, I'm fucking him. We just don't. So what we're saying is that even in the instances where we're already in our minds like, oh, I'm gonna fuck him. When you bring up sex too soon, it immediately turns us off and now we like, now I gotta make this nigga wait. Or now I gotta cut this nigga off because he done fucked up.
Okay, well, you know what? You know, I think each situation is different. That's all I'm saying. Each situation is different.
Let me read some comments.
Because it's been times. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? What? Shit.
First class boxer says, in a 5-minute convo, I will know whether this will work or not by body language and responses. Flips and Designs is laughing at you talking about a full sentence. That's too funny. Listen, do you meet a lot of women that can't make full sentences?
Listen, I promise you, and I'm not joking, there's women out here who don't use full sentences. They don't use fucking vowels. And I'm like, who the fuck? Listen, I can't, you know, nah, I can't, nah. I need you to speak a full sentence to me, okay? If you can't speak a full sentence, if you don't use vowels, then, like, nah, I can't fuck you. We ain't about to do this.
You're not even gonna fuck her if she can't make a full sentence?
I didn't say that, but it'll just be that.
It'll just be that. In our age group, we're old enough to establish whether we want sex up front or not. First Class Boxer says, women today run more game than an Xbox. They want to be in control of the environment just as much as we do, if not more. Mama B says, if I want sex, I'm going to say it. No shame here. Pretty Driven says, men can't handle it either, so I just lie too. Roz says, we are more honest about it. Yes. Exactly. I'm not saying that doesn't happen. I'm just saying I think women are just more honest about it, right? We're just more upfront about it. We don't waste a whole lot of time, you know what I mean, without letting y'all know, like, you nice. I think you're a really nice guy. But honestly, I'm just not in a space where I want to be in a relationship. I don't want to be tied down. I just got divorced. I just got out of a marriage. I don't really, you know what I mean? I just want to have a good time. We might not use the words, I just want to fuck you. But we're going to say something like, I just want to have a good time. I don't really want to be in a relationship. And I let you know right there, we fucking. Like, that's pretty much all we do.
It's the same thing. I think we as men, we just might have a slightly different approach. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, but, you know, listen, it already got to be 9:25 and I have a heated question.
Okay.
I need to know, is this a deal breaker for y'all? Would you date? I guess you have to date them because I don't know how they got it after you was in a relationship. But even if they found out after they were in a relationship, because we don't always know. Would you date or be in a relationship with someone that you know has an incurable STD, like HIV, herpes, syphilis.
Nigga, like, where the fuck did that come from? Like, I don't even understand. Do you just sit around and just think of shit to say? Like, I don't even understand.
First of all, I'm this hot topic, right? And now that we have 4 shows a week, I have to sit around thinking about what the hell we're going to talk about next show.
Where the fuck did that question need to come from? Nigga? Like, you just sit on the couch.
Let me tell you where it came from. So I told you, we're poly, right? So I had this dude, he was the first dude, because we had just talked about all the shit we got to deal with when we meet a guy, right? So he was the first dude that I actually really liked, right? I liked him. I mean, I was smitten with him, right? I was planning my trip to go see this nigga. Like, I liked him a lot. He was like, let's look up flights. We talked every day, hours on end. I was really feeling him. And so a friend of mine hit me up out the blue. Backstory. There was another lady in the group who was very interested in me. And she was pursuing me or whatever. And I told him about her. And he was like, oh, that's my ex. So I was like, okay, I don't have a problem with that being your ex, but I'm going to tell her now that you and I are dealing with each other because I like shit to be up front. So I told her, she knew about me and him. She didn't have a problem with it. She said he was a great guy. Anyway, fast forward. Out the blue, a friend of mine inboxes me and she asked me the same exact question. Would you deal with somebody that you knew had an incurable? So my answer was no. Like, no, who the hell would do that? Why would I do that? So I'm telling him, because I'm telling you, like I really, we talked every day. So I'm telling him about my day and I'm telling him, this girl asked me out the blue. And at that time, he decided to reveal to me that his current girlfriend had herpes. Mm. And he said that he had been dealing with her for about 8 months, that he doesn't like, and prior to that, he had sent me like a screenshot of his STD results. And I didn't think anything of it because, you know what I mean? We're poly, we're out in these streets. It's adult of us to make sure, you know what I'm saying? That like we're straight or whatever. So I figured he just sent me the picture to let me know he was good. Now I'm adding it up and I'm like, oh, he sent me the picture because it said herpes negative, right? So he says that she has herpes. They've been dealing with each other for 8 months. He's never gotten it. He just had sent me the picture of the STD or whatever. So we start talking about whether she has a flare up and this, that, and the third. And he was like, and I'm letting you know this in advance so you can make some decisions, right? So I'm like, shit, you know what I mean? Fuck, I like this. Like, I like this dude, right? And when I say I like this dude, I liked him enough that like, when he told me, my immediate answer wasn't like, oh, fuck no. So I was on a Zoom. We do a Zoom with our poly group. It's called Intense Fellowship. So I was on the Zoom with my poly group and I was asking them, what do you guys think about, you know, incurables? And so a lot of people, we had one person on there that was a scientist, one that's a doctor by profession, one that's a nurse. They all came on and they were like, you know, herpes is far more out there than people think it is, right? And they were like, you know, herpes isn't as bad as we make it to be. A lot of people have herpes and it's lying dormant. In fact, when you go get your STD panel, you might not even be being tested for herpes because because it causes such hysteria when you know about it, that, you know, so they don't even do that test unless you specifically say, can you test me for herpes? Because they don't want you to be all, you know, up in arms when it comes back and says, you know, you have this in your system. So I'm like, wow. So anyway, I really considered, like, okay, well, based upon what they said and based upon what I'm hearing, maybe I can still make this work. Ultimately, I didn't, because I came back to reality and I was like, you know, I'm not the only person involved in this relationship or whatever. I have a husband. My husband don't want herpes. You know what I'm saying? And it's a lot going on. So we ended what we had and now we're just friends. But so now I'm asking y'all, like, would you, and you see all the time, Cookie stayed with Mantic, right? She ain't got the HIV yet.
Yeah, but I mean,
I saw before I started talking, a lot of people were saying that it's a hell no for them. It's a hard no. It's a no. You got to go. Everybody's saying no. Then somebody said, so many people walking around here with the hurt and don't even know. See, I just told you, you got it and you don't even know. Tanya says, not being circumcised is a deal breaker for her. Tanya, now that's a different subject, but I'm with you, right? You got to be circumcised. Like, I'm too old to be, it's too much. Anyway, penicillin has cured syphilis for decades. Everybody's saying no to the incurable diseases. And everybody's saying no to being uncircumcised. Roz says uncircumcised isn't a big deal to me as long as he has good hygiene. But Roz, you don't know if he has good hygiene until you pull that turtleneck back. Then what? You pull that turtleneck back, well, there's lint shit all in there, and you don't even know. Like, what you got? I don't know. It's a no for me. I don't got time for it. Yes, most people do know that a cold sore is herpes, but you know there's herpes simplex 1 and 2. So cold sores are a form of herpes. Ross says a hard dick looks the same whether circumcised or not. Okay, so what's your answer, Paul? Because I think the audience has weighed in and they say it's a no for them on any incurable. What's your answer?
Man, listen. That's always that tricky question, because when you hear the shit, right, especially like herpes, like that's always a very, very tricky fucking question, because it's true though, like you could have it and you could not even motherfucking know that shit. You know what I'm saying? You could be toting this shit around right now and not know. Because it's something that it's from what I understand, it's like it's a flare up or some shit, you know what I'm saying?
So like lie dormant in your system. And so as long as you don't do anything to cause a flare up, you may never know.
Right. So I think it would probably be two situations for me. Right. So like if I just met a chick, we started to talk or whatever like that, and she was like, okay, look, I'm attracted to you. I think you're attracted to me, but before I give you a shot of this ass, I'm gonna let you know something. I got herpes. Then I'm gonna probably be like, whoa, the fuck you mean you got it? Fuck you. You know what I'm saying? Then I'm gonna probably panic. And I'm probably panicking, like I'm gonna be out of it. You know what I'm saying? But like, what if you're with somebody and you done already fucked them like 50 fucking times, and then they go to the doctor and get a checkup, and then all of a sudden they like, well, babe, I got something to tell you. What the fuck you gotta tell me? And I don't know. Went to the doctor and some shit felt funny down there, and I got a flare up, and he like, I got the shit, and I'm like, God damn it. So it's like, you'd be stuck in a conundrum, just like, I done already fucked 50 times already, so 9 times out of 10, that's possible. I could already have this shit. So you know what I'm saying? So in a situation like that, I don't know. You know what I'm saying? Like if it's some new shit that I never did before, if you tell me, I'm probably gonna be out of there. But in a situation like that, it's like, what do you do? It's like, I'd be stuck. You know what I'm saying? So I don't know. Me personally,
but
I'm
what,
clean.
But what about? So I'm assuming that if you're in that situation, right, one of the first things you do is be like, I need to make a doctor's appointment, right? So then you go to the doctor, and your results come back negative. Do you now end that relationship, or what would you do, you think?
I don't know. That's a tricky one. That's a tricky one. That's like a tricky situation. You know what I mean? Because like, so there's like, if you've been telling this person you care about, I don't know.
Yeah, I love you.
And all this other shit. It's like
so many variables. Now like, we live together. Like, we got kids and shit. And like,
right. It's like that. What do you really do in a situation like that? You're like, God damn it. You know what I mean? I don't know. That would be a trick.
Our audience is Mama B said, "Nope, can't do it."
That would be a tricky.
One Scorpio Chicken said, "I would end it. If I go to the doctor and I find out I'm straight, and you done found out you're not straight, we ain't gonna be able to do it. We ain't gonna be straight no more because I'm straight. You not. We no longer straight."
That would be a trick. You know me. I can't know my thing. Please, I gotta.
Pretty Driven says it takes a mature adult decision. So Pretty Driven, what would you do in that situation? Look who came to join us, guys. It's my favorite guy.
What up, B?
What up? What's going on?
It's my bae. One Scorpio Chicken said, nope, it's done. Now, listen, so Brian, you know, we're married, so we, y'all have... Y'all think that we have like random talks on this show, but y'all have no idea the random conversations that me and Brian have together. So I know this story. So when Brian came in, I was like, you can tell them your story. So Brian is going to tell you about his situation where he had to make a decision on an incurable.
Let me just start by saying the decision wasn't hard. Anytime. I am a firm believer of anything you sell to me too hard, I don't want. But aside from that, I met this female. We was kicking it. We was talking from time to time. We was talking on the phone every once in a while and everything. And I went to go see her one day. She was like, I feel like I should probably tell you now. I was like, tell me what? So, you know, my dumb ass, I'm like, well, you got another kid or something? I don't know about what's going on. She's like, no. I have HIV, but it's harder for a woman to give it to a man than a man to give it to a woman. I was like, I don't give a fuck who it's hard to give it to. I ain't gonna be in the equation. I'm good.
So, but you really liked her?
No, she was all right.
Well, maybe, what you think it would have been different if you really liked her?
I doubt it.
Now, listen, okay, I'm gonna just, HIV is a different monster than like herpes in my mind, right? Or is it not?
What happened now?
I said HIV is a different monster than like herpes in my mind. Or is it not? Like if it,
I mean, it just, I think it all depends on the individual. Like if you're like, you know, like, again, the thing about, I don't know a lot about herpes. I really don't know. Only thing I do know is like, I don't have the shit. Like I got a clean dick, clean bill of health, you know what I'm saying, type of shit. So I don't know. But the one thing I do know about it is like, I do know that you could have it and just not know because you don't have a flare up. So like, if you don't have a flare up, you don't know until that shit flares the fuck
up.
And
you know what? Because again, same thing with HIV. When you go to the doctor and just say, "Hey, I want to get an STD check," for insurance purposes, you have to specifically say, "I want an HIV test," because they don't just automatically give it to you just because you say, "I want you to test me for all STDs."
Oh no, yeah. So you know me, for various reasons, but the main reason, in order for me to, well, we as trainers, in order for us to keep your boxing license and shit, and we're always around blood and contact and shit like that, you know, you gotta go get tested like all the fucking time. You know what I'm saying? So then you go get tested for that shit, you be like, well, shit, I'm here. test me for everything. You know what I mean? So you just end up getting a full workup and shit like that. You know what I'm saying? So, you know. But yeah.
Okay. Nitra says, to me, HIV is more of a death sentence. Herpes is not killing people. She also says some people never have a flare-up, so then you throw it. My comments moved. You throw all those years out the window. She says, I know some HIV positive people who say they can't transfer the disease to their partners. I'm not sure how that's possible, but I guess. Yeah. Then one Scorpio Chica says it's true. Pretty Driven says, but I have worked closely with HIV positive people and it's changed my mind on how to treat people. One Scorpio Chica says the new combination of drugs for HIV brings your viral load so low you no longer test positive and cannot transmit it. Sneezy says, my friend got herpes when she was 17 from the second person she ever had sex with. She is now married to someone who is negative and they have several children together. Pretty Driven says, I've seen teenagers, gays, grandparents, all types, so I judge no more. One Scorpio Chica says, I would with HIV folk in Baltimore County. It's hard to get them to be responsible knowing they can't transmit it. Sneezy says, you specifically have to ask for the test, saying test me for everything still may not get you the test you need. Correct. You have to specifically say, I want to be tested for HIV. I want to be tested for herpes. Because they just give you a general panel and they come back and say, oh, you tested negative for chlamydia and gonorrhea, right? So you have to specifically ask for them.
Listen, I'm 49 years old. I ain't had nothing. And ain't nobody gonna mess with my track record. I don't give a damn how cool we are, how fine you might be, how well you might treat me.
So wait a minute. Are you saying that if I found out...
said it.
You're saying that if I found out I had HIV next week that you would leave me?
Yeah. Where did you get it from? You ain't had it before?
It was lying dormant in my system. What
it
you
wasn't
mean?
That dormant. Don't give me that shit.
It can lie dormant in your system.
I know that.
So what you mean it wasn't that dormant? Do y'all hear this? I feel like I should feel some type of way about this.
Listen, it ain't much.
Thank you, Nitra. Damn. She says, damn.
It ain't a whole lot. I got a perfect track record in. This is one of them, but I intend to hold on to that.
So, wait a minute. How many of y'all can say that you've never in your life had an STD?
Excuse me?
You heard the question. You've never in your life had an STD?
Ever?
Besides Ever. Brian.
Well, I mean, I had one time. One time.
Me too. It only took once for me. I had the crabs, because that was back before they were shaving the coochie hairs, and I had the crabs. I was like 16, and I was like, why am I so itchy? Go to the doctor, and he's like, oh, you have pubic lice. What?
One time. Like, when I was 14, I had some shit when I was 14. I just started my career fucking, and, you know what I mean? And I was,
You know what? We're going to get back to the fact that you called it a career.
Yeah, I had a career. I had a career in fucking. I thought I was going to be, I did. I thought I was going to, you know, it was something that I knew that I wanted to do regularly because I started so soon. So, yeah, that's what happened. So
we have a question from Roz. She said, if it's not too personal of a question, since you guys are poly, do you have rules where you have to use condoms with the other people, or do you require tests from the others? Both. It's both, Roz. We actually just had a conversation because I was reading something and it said something about fluid exchange or something, and I was like, fluid bonded. Thank you, babe. And I was like, babe. Do we have rules about being fluid bonded? He was like, what the hell does that mean? And I was like, well, fluid bond, it means that, you know, we exchange fluids, you know, with other partners. Do we have rules about that? And he was like, I'm not exchanging no fluids with no other partners. I'm using condoms. And so I was like, okay. So, I mean, for me, it's always kind of been a rule for me, particularly when you're a new partner, that you use condoms any fucking way, because I told y'all about the pubic lice at 16. And since then, I've been clean and I've been straight and I'm trying to stay that way. So we use condoms and we want STD tests. Like, you know, to me, because again, I don't personally want to knowingly have sex with someone that has HIV, whether they use a condom or not. It's just my personal preference. Right. It's a no for me. So it's both for us. Nitra says crabs. What does that feel like? So crabs is just like extremely itchy. Like I said, it was back during the time before we were shaving and stuff. So it was, I was just so like the kind of itch that you can't ever stop scratching. It was so itchy that I just was like, something is wrong. So I went to the doctor. He said I had pubic lice. He told me to go to the store, buy the Ridex, the same thing, stuff that you use for head lice. And when you buy the Ridex, it comes with a comb and you comb it out and you can see the little tiny bugs on the comb when you comb it out, right? I was just like, oh my God, I was devastated. One Scorpio Chica, do you use condoms for oral also? We do not, but Brian hasn't performed oral on another woman besides me since we've been together. Neither have I said Brian like I have. Neither of us have performed oral on anyone else since we've been together. I already told y'all on another show that, like, I don't even really love sucking dick, right? So if I'm sucking a dick, it's because I got to really feel it in my spirit, particularly a dick that don't belong to me. So, but I, you know, I kind of agree with the logic that, like, if you're going to eat a pussy, you might as well fuck them raw. And I know there's a whole debate about that. But so, no, we don't. We haven't had to use oral condoms, and we probably won't if we chose to make that decision. What we say to each other is that we trust each other and we trust each other's judgment. So whatever Brian decided to do, I trust his judgment. He's just told y'all he's lived 49 years without getting STD. So if he decided that he just had to eat this woman's pussy, it's not that big of a deal to me. Why do you keep saying mm? He in the background keeps saying mm. Why do you keep saying mm?
I don't believe
you. You don't believe me?
No.
Why?
Well, I don't.
What you mean? Some STIs can be transferred even with the use of a condom. Correct. Like crabs, right? You can get crabs even if you use condoms because they really attach to, like, your hair. So they say you can get crabs even, like, from sitting on a toilet seat or whatever. So,
I mean, you could, but it's highly unlikely if that could happen. It's highly unlikely that it would happen or you would get it like that. Yeah, but yeah. So, like I said, one time when I was 14, but
wait, which one did you have?
I think it was gonorrhea when I was like 14 and shit.
Ryan said that's not what it was. He said it was crabs.
No, it was gonorrhea. It was gonorrhea. I had the gonorrhea shit. Yeah, I had that when I was like 14. And it was like really, really burning and itching and shit. But I didn't know what it was because I basically had just started fucking. So I didn't really know.
You had just started your career.
Yeah, I just started fucking. Like, it was like, you know, I just started. Like, how the fuck did you just start? Like, you know what I'm saying? And then, yeah, it was burning and shit. And yeah, it was bad. So I didn't know for like a long time because I didn't want to tell my mom that I was burning. So, you know, so then by the time I finally end up telling her, then you had to go to the doctor and you couldn't just get you couldn't just take a pill at this point. Like, you had to take a shot and get a shot in your ass. Yeah,
I was great. So you had to get a shot in your dick?
No, not in your dick, in your ass. They don't get a shot in your dick, you get it in your ass. Yeah.
Pretty Driven says she was dirty.
Huh?
She was dirty.
Yeah, I had just started out having sex and I was like, but yeah, it was one of those situations. But then it was like a situation where she was like, well, she said she didn't know or some shit like that. So
Now, Ross says you can get herpes from skin to skin. And Sneedy says, yes, that's why they say you shouldn't shave all the way down. I don't.
Sports there.
I don't like this whole conversation. It's making me uncomfortable. So I guess the consensus is that STDs and STIs are a deal breaker.
And I'm thinking in most cases probably.
But Paul is saying not necessarily a deal breaker. Because he said again, that if we were like in a relationship, we already been fucking. I ain't got it yet. So I told you about the dude I was talking about. Like, I asked him, I was like, so, like, do you eat our pussy? And he was like, he has once or twice, but not on a regular basis. And so if you were in that situation, would you, like, change your sexual habits now? Like, would you then want to start using condoms and you hadn't previously been using them? Like, do you feel like you want to change your sexual habits if you stayed with him?
If I was in that situation?
Yeah.
Again, I don't, in a situation like that, I don't know. Like, I don't even fucking know. You know what I'm saying? It's just that, again, that's just a tricky situation, especially if you care about the person, you like the person, it, you know, who knows? If you've already been fucking a person for like 50,000 fucking times, I don't know. I think I would be scared at the, because like, it's one thing to do it and you don't know. But then to do it and you do know, then it's like, then a whole bunch of other questions would come up. Like, well, how do you know that you're not having a flare up right now? Is it possible that you could have one and not fucking know, like, right now?
There, you're doing a full-on,
you know what I'm saying? You like,
you got your magnifying glass.
Yeah, like, you said something. So I don't know.
Wait a minute. Before I eat this pussy, you got the magnifying glass out. That's a good question. Supreme Driller says, how did these young people get this shit so early? Were they fucking old people? That's a good question. But I think, like, these young people, first of all, always feel invincible. They always feel like it will never be me, not me. It won't happen to me. And I think that they, like, always rely on the word of each other, right? Teenagers, for whatever reason, if somebody said this is what it is, they just believe it, right? They just haven't gotten to the stage where they're like from the show me state, right? So they just believe that this person said that they were clean. They said they were a virgin. They said they're not fucking nobody else. So I, you know what I mean? And so I think that's probably how it started.
Yeah, it was like my first.
Pre-driven says stuff the balls in the condom too.
That's uncomfortable.
Brian said that's uncomfortable. Stuff the balls in the condom too.
Oh shit! Yeah, that would be painful, very painful.
Ball cozies.
Nitra says, I think if the person with the STD goes on a daily suppressive therapy, then condoms are needed. Well, listen, you have to make the decisions that are best for you and your health and your mental health. And I'm not in any way swaying anyone one way or the other. I let everybody be great. One Scorpio Chica says, teens and young adults live in the moment. You know your brain isn't fully developed till 25. And for men, I don't think it's fully developed till like 35.
Oh, you got jokes. You got jokes.
Because they out there, you know, in their fucking career. So they don't even.
I mean, it was like I said, I was 14. Like, I was 14 years old and I jumped out there, you know, for my first time. And the very first time I slid up in some shit, and she was like, but I didn't know. You know what I'm saying? She said she didn't know, and you know, so it was bad.
And so then that's the other question: Do you call like your former partners and do you tell them, or do you just be like, shit, they gave it to me, they gonna find out on their own?
No, I mean, I was, again, when it happened, I was 14. Like, she was the first, like, literally the first
Pretty
person.
Pretty Driven wants to know, was she an older woman?
No, it was in high school. The very first time I had sex, the very first woman that I ever had sex with, she got me.
And you haven't had an STD since then?
No.
Nobody got time for that. Okay. Let me just tell you, I would just be honest and say, I haven't had an STD since then by the grace of God, right? Literally by the grace of God, because I am not going to lie to y'all and tell y'all that when I was younger, every single time I had protected sex and I, you know what I mean? Like, for I was living la vida loca for a little while till HIV came out, right? When HIV came out, I was like, oh, shit is real, right? And then, like I told y'all, for like 10 years, because they said it could lay dormant for 10 years, every year I would get tested and be like, "Ooh, another year, thank God." Because I just was not certain that the way I was living, it was going to come out negative every time.
Right.
She said she burning in high school. It's a lot of high schoolers. You know where else the STD rate is very high? Nursing homes. Nursing homes, I've worked in several. Nursing homes STD rates are very high because I think they think, like young people, we old, you know what I mean? We ain't doing a whole lot of nothing. And the STD rate in nursing homes is extremely high because they're not using condoms. They old, they having a good time.
Throwing that thing back.
Nitra says, I used to work with this lady and she got herpes the first time having sex. She was very bitter and mean. Talk about devastating. Yeah, I have a friend that was like that. She was like 16 and she got syphilis. And it was like, wow. She was in college. Yeah, nursing home has some of those old people in those nursing homes. First of all, that's because you're old don't mean you don't have urges, right? And I'm telling you, I've worked at 3 nursing homes. And we have to have like meetings and stuff like that. And that's why they work so hard to keep people in nursing homes from having sex with each other. Because the STD rate in nursing homes is sky high. It looks like we have about 3 minutes left in the show.
Yes, we do. 3 minutes left.
So we are wrapping it up. This has been a good time, folks. We appreciate you guys joining us. We'll be back on Tuesday. We're taking a day off. We're going to celebrate Dr. King tomorrow, even though I don't think black folks do a lot to celebrate Dr. King. But we're going to celebrate the fact that as black folks, most of us that are off get paid to be off on his day.
Absolutely.
Tanya says, I enjoyed the show. This is my first show tuning in. First time tuning in. Loved it. Thank you, Tanya.
We're so glad you chose to
tune in with us. Hopefully, we'll see you on Tuesday. Tuesday, what are we talking about on Tuesday? Did we talk about it? I couldn't remember what we figured out.
I don't know. What you want to talk about?
But we're talking about something good on Tuesday. We always try to talk about something good. I will be off. We will be off tomorrow. So you guys enjoy your MLK day. Remember why we have the day off, even if it's just for a hot second, because as we talked about on the show before, we haven't overcome as much as we'd like to believe that we have. So
this is true. We have not overcome just yet, but we are hopefully moving forward, leaning and going.
Yeah, because in Maryland, we'll talk about that on another show, but you guys are going through all that with Mosby. With the state's attorney,
all that. It's a lot of stuff that's going on right now in here in Maryland. So, but I want to say thank you to everyone who decided to tune in. Thank you again. Please tell more people. Again, we want to give a big shout out to WMEG radio station, who we are so happily and proudly to be affiliated with. Thank you guys for tuning in to Steel Radio. I'm your man, Steel. That's Ebony, a.k.a. Miss Hot Topic. Again, please. Brian, a.k.a. the Green Eyed Genie, a.k.a. B-Rabbit. Thank you for tuning in, brother. Coming in better late than never. Love to see your face, man. I'm glad to see your face. Glad to hear you here. And thank you for everyone tuning in. Again, we don't own the rights.
See you on Tuesday.
And we will see you guys on Tuesday. We love you. We out of here. Peace.
Peace. Good night.